My name is Marcus. I'm the compiler of a collection of therapy quotes entitled 1001 Windmills of the Mind, a collection of advanced self-help quotes taken from what's often called the psychodynamic or the psychoanalytic perspective, which long ago, as I understand it, was referred to by some as philosophical medicine or narrative medicine, the love of narrative medicine. So we now have 10,000 of these types of quotes in our collection. And just before coming out this morning, I took a peek at Gregory Bauer's book called Wit and Wisdom in Dynamic Psychotherapy. And that's the first sort of collection to my knowledge of psychoanalytic quotes in one source in that book. So it's a book, but it's a collection of quotes. So that was done several decades ago. And I've already plucked out what I think are the best quotes of his selection. And I just revisited that book, and I missed some, so we'll be including more of Bauer's selected quotes, so I'm glad I caught them. Another good collection of psychoanalytic quotes, just recently discovered, a very short time ago, was done by a guy named Henry Hart, and he published sort of like a notebook, not really like a quotes book. He just made his own little personal notes, summary statements of some of the articles that he read in his lifetime. And in 1970, before he passed, he managed to publish this massive collection of notes. And I didn't know it existed. It was a limited print. Not many people had it or knew about it. Luckily, some university withdrew it, and it got uploaded somehow. So luckily, that one, maybe like the last surviving copy of his notes, got digitized in the archives and all that. So I've been going through those notes and plucking out his summary statements. Now, the vast majority of it is vague and just paraphrases the title of the article, nothing really too special. But once in a while, there is something really good in there, and I've been plucking out those gems from Mr. Hart there. So we posted already almost 300 notes, or close to 300 notes there. So we got Bauer's collection. I took the best from him. Mr. Hart, I'm in the process of getting the best of his. Okay. And then, and that's it. Now we have 1001 Windmills of the Mind, the best of the best out there. So we're collecting the greatest hits of psychoanalysis. Now that fancy term just means know yourself. It just means know yourself. The premise, the basic premise, as distinct from regular psychology, the difference between general pop psychology or academic psychology, is that psychoanalysis believes quite strongly that the child creates a memory system. He records and creates an internal working model based on the interaction with the mother. And he creates a kind of stencil, template, blueprint, working model, intrapsychic society, intrapsychic setup, some kind of psychic. And he has memories of himself, the relation to the mother, and different forms of it called relational units. And if the baby lays down a problem intrapsychic or interpersonal model based on interaction, and it's problematic like that, he's gonna depend on that. He's gonna see the world through that, because that's how he survived with the mother, that's how he understood the mother, that's how he understood himself in relation to the mother, who was the world. So he sees the world through the lens of yesterday. He reads today through the lens of yesterday, kind of thing. Now here's the question. If the child is loved by the mother and he lays down a normal model, he's okay, mother's okay, and he has the memories of mother soothing him and seeing him and being there for him, mother meeting his needs, then he can pick up on that, internalizes that as a part of his self, as himself or herself, then that person continues that tradition with themselves. That's the normal state of affairs. They feel safe with themselves, they have an identity, they know the gifts that the Great Spirit gave them, which they express. That's loving life, meaning, pleasure, happiness, and so on. So if the child doesn't get basically I'm okay, you're okay, a model in the mind, if the child instead gets a model that says, gee, I'm no good, mother's dangerous, well, I can't admit that, let's make up another, let's fantasize a delusion, mother's wonderful and I'm special, and and then you make up these either or kind of things as a coping strategy to deal with the mother not meeting the baby's needs. So the baby adapts to a frustrating mother, misattuned mother, by using various strategies in the mind called defense mechanisms. It helps him to adapt to his frustrating mother, but he has a memory system of how he adapted, and it's set there, and he goes to life repeating it. Now that's a pain like that, because in the process of doing so, he didn't get mother's love, and he still has that original need for mother's love. So there's a pain there and a conflict like that. Simple, basic Pavlovian classical conditioning. Okay, to know the needs, he's reminded of the pain, but he still has the needs. Hence the huge conflict, inner conflict called the wish and the fear, basically. A little luck today, yeah. So I was here yesterday, and it was nice. It was nice. I was really in a strange mood yesterday. So let's see how today goes. Maybe a little better, I think. Let's see. Although it's funny, in that strange mood, I was a little regressed. So I noticed I did have a Freudian slip. I didn't, to my surprise, during that video yesterday, I blurped out something I thought it wouldn't say. I didn't mean to say, didn't plan to say. It just kind of leaped up like a frog. You know, that's Whitman's image of Freudian slips. So the in Myths of Fairy Tales, when there's a scene of a forest, that's a symbol of this other world. It's dark, mysterious, known, dangerous, unknown, swamp, dark, can't see, unknown. Anyway, storytellers would describe a forest as a symbol for our unconscious. Now, and Whitman says, yeah, in the forest, there's going to be frogs in there, right? Sure, there'll be some ponds somewhere and frogs. Okay. So let's say you're talking to somebody, and unknowingly, a frog leaps up. So I had that yesterday. I left it fine. I just left it. So I keep all my bloopers and mistakes, and I want to analyze myself too. I haven't analyzed. I'm not a shrink. I'm not a professor. Disclaimer. I'm not a shrink. I'm not a professor. I'm not a midwife, doula, nutritionist, gynecologist. No master's. No training in counseling or psychology. Nothing like that. I have a simple BA. I'm the compiler of the quotes. I'm trying to learn this perspective. You know, if you want to learn this perspective, you need a minimum, they say, a rock bottom minimum master's of social work, plus years and years of experience in that field. And then maybe a shrink school will accept you or something. Probably not. They prefer either PhDs with psychology or PhDs in literature, or better yet, medical doctors. So it's kind of hard to get into these shrink schools, analytic institutes kind of thing. And who knows nowadays the condition of them. It seems like a little bit of a question mark there. Anyways, somebody said, well, if you want to learn something, teach it. So obviously I don't see myself as formally teaching any of this because I'm trying to learn it myself. So the compromise is I'm discussing it. I'm finding the quotes, sharing and talking about it. That helps me to kind of learn it a little bit. So my give back for these anxious deliveries is that the quotes are posted below. So in each video, you get on average 10 quotes. Today's a good example. There might be 10. Let's see how many. What is it today? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. So on average, we post 9 quotes. Sometimes just one. Sometimes there's 30. So there's on average 10 quotes. And the hope being that 1 out of 10 will be of interest to anybody. Now, this is for people at midlife, by the way. This is for people in the second half of life. Okay, when they reach that midpoint in life, where they feel like, what are these Freudian slips about? What's that about? Well, something that you've been denying, some pain or something you want to say, and you didn't. It's buried like that. You're denying something that's truthful about you, and it just leaps out because it's just so desperate to get to be included into your personality, to be included. It wants, your unconscious wants to be accepted. Right? Your wounded inner child of the past, okay, who you'd be had you been loved, okay, with the gifts and all that, it wants to be in you. It wants to animate through you. It wants to be alive. Like, so this is called embodiment or sense of self, ontological self, feeling self, authentic self, true self, real self. See, a lot of that's frozen with trauma, and then we develop a false self. So we go through the first half of life, generally speaking, with the false self, this defensive self. And yes, with the defensive self, we materially understand the present. And we can drive a car, pay the bills, get 10 PhDs, get 10 medals, write 10 hit songs, and invent things maybe. So we can do a lot of things and materially like that. But we really live to the sense that we feel embodied, sense of self, to the extent that we feel. If you're going through life and you feel like, where's your feelings? Where's your at home within feeling? Where's that that comfortable connection to your authentic self, your real self, your true self. So you feel like something missing like that. That's the famous split between the true self and the false self kind of thing. Now this comes to your attention at midlife kind of thing. Now in midlife, people may initiate, this is initiated to them, either through their Freudian slips, you know, saying like, come on, listen to me, because the Freudian slips is from your true self. Right? Like these Freudian slips, like that little angry outburst I said, that's like a little anger on my side, right? So that kind of leaped out like that. Usually it's like a little anger statement or usually it's like an because you're angry because you've been denying the truth and you're not feeling the truth. So there's a pain like that. And then anger is a result of that kind of thing. So that's the Freudian slips. So people might, at midlife, start saying these obnoxious things to people unknowingly and then catch themselves and apologize and analyze, where did that come from? Whoa, you know, that's maybe one way it happens. But generally speaking, it's a hunch. Generally speaking, people say to themselves, gee, I don't know what it is, but something's missing. Something's off here. I don't know what it is. I feel like I'm living the provisional life, the unlived life. When does life begin, really, like feeling-wise? When do they enjoy things or something? Or they might recognize they're not enjoying things. They're just sleepwalking through life, going through the motions of life, in a swoon, in a trance. Okay, like a little hypnotized almost. They're just going through the motions of life. So they function all that, but they're just like in a bit of a dream like that all the time. One guy said, I just feel like I'm a little bit drunk all the time, he said. He doesn't drink alcohol. He just says, he joked, he said, I don't need it. I'm always drunk, he said. That's a symptom of a trauma like that, a little bit slightly disassociative state in trauma, and it can be set like that. So the brain is sending him endorphins all the time, which numbs the person. So he's going through life kind of numb like that. Sometimes people say at midlife, gee, aren't I supposed to feel sad if there's a loss? Like there might be a divorce or something, and they just act like, well, I don't know, they just pretend like nothing happened. And they wonder about that. That's something strange, isn't it? Aren't I supposed to like admit that there was some kind of loss here? And like feel sad that all that was lost? And the dreams that we had and the times and suddenly it's all gone or something? And they don't even register that feeling of sadness. Why? Because sadness is linked to your authentic identity, your beingness, your authentic self, your true self, your real self, your beingness. You're at home with him. Sadness can come from there, joy can come from there. But if that's all frozen up in trauma, the person doesn't feel sad because the beingness is frozen. I feel that I am. The amness, no authentic amness, no authentic primary feelings like joy and sadness. So a Disney film is set out, joy and sadness got zooped away. And then the person went back to the survival brain. So if there's a loss at midlife, a person can't mourn, so they deny it and go numb and just deny it and then just go on like that. And then maybe there's a delayed onset. Now the Freudian slip gets bigger. Now later on they might be a little more irritable with people or something because they never mourn. So a lot of people think, a lot of shrinks have the general consensus that all the problems out there in the world, you name it, fill in the blank, whatever it is, it's because we're not mourning. You see, and all the pain of it all, and then we're acting out to distract ourselves or to communicate our anger because we don't have our beingness to mourn. So the whole purpose of therapy is to mourn. Then we're back to our normal state where joy and sadness run the console. Mainly joy runs the console, the serene inexhaustible fullness of being, because you have your sense of beingness and there's a calm, pleasant feeling like that. And when you have your feelings, that's your yin, okay? That's your beingness. Okay? So I think Shakti's also for that. Lou Graham calls it the midnight blue. It's not a bad one. So this is your sense of beingness. And when you have your beingness, A, you've got your feelings. That means you're going to be ethical and moral and virtuous because you have your feelings. So there'll be empathy, reparation, regret, feel badly for mistakes, so you want to make amends. This is the more, quote unquote, more human side of being human, which is really the main human area, right? The normal kind of human area, the functioning, quote unquote, normal, when we have our feelings like that. We're not dysfunctional, we're normal like that. And one way to use that phrase inside out is if you have that insideness, meaning your beingness, then your doingness is normal. Okay, Woodman, back to Woodman again, she has the line that if you have the feminine element, she calls the beingness and the yin and the shakti and all the feminine element, the feminine principle. She says that, well, if the feminine is wounded, well, then the masculine, the doing, the active, the yang, the Shiva, the yang, the doing, the cherry red, the Lou Graham's one, your active kind of like the sun, and you got the moon, and you got the sun, and you got the night, the beingness, and the day, like sun, night, a sun, moon, at day, night. These kind of images kind of imply this two sides of ourselves, the beingness and the doingness. Now you want your doingness to come from your beingness. Now if your beingness is frozen, you don't have your beingness, and you can't do inside out, okay, then the masculine, Woodman says, is distorted, it's whacked, it's messed up, it's toxic, it's harmful, because you're doing, because number one, it's angry because you're not feeling, so it's hurtful like that. Number two, you're grasping for something symbolic of mother in the present, thinking it'll take you back in a time machine to change what had happened in the past so you can get the love that was needed back in the past. So you're still grasping for that old missing need that was needed back in the past. So when your beingness is missing, your doingness is trying to looking for symbolic mother, but no symbol of mother is going to correct what had happened in the past. It did happen. The templates are there, but you're still looking to undo it or change it. No, it doesn't make sense. Kristen Wilson says, yeah, if you don't have that beingness, she calls it embodiment, sense of at home within the embodiment. She says, if you're not in your body, her line is, if you're not embodied, you're not making sense, literally. You don't have your sense of self. Plus, you're not making sense in your doing, because in your doing, you're grasping for something on the outside, looking for mother's love that was needed back in the past. It's not going to register, because there's no time machines. You can't change what happened in the past. It's not making sense like that. And then part B is, you're angry at what your mother did. So you might be, one version of it is you might want to show up the mother. You might want to tell the world how angry you are at the mother. So you treat others the way the mother treated you as a way of saying, look how my mother treated me. See how I'm treating, how badly I'm treating others. Well, look world, look at it. Where did I learn this? Somebody taught me this, people, come on. I'm showing you my anger at the mother. I'm trying to expose her, how hurtful she was to me. I want to be seen. I want to express my anger at her, so I'm showing you what she did. So they treat others the way the mother treated them to tell the world how the mother treated them. So we're not making sense like that. Really, doing that, do you think it's going to take you back in the time machine? The mother's going to say, oh, wait a minute, I better love my baby, because if I don't, they'll be so negative like that in the future and hurt others in the future. So let me love the baby. And so change. It's not making sense. This is the reason, part of this reason none of this makes sense is because when the baby's traumatized, that takes place in the part of the brain. The baby's brain, he's mainly in a survival kind of area, because he wouldn't make it without the mother. The baby, if the baby doesn't get his mother's needs, he's a goner. He thinks he's a goner. If he can't make it, no baby can make it on their own without a mother. So he's terrified of this. So he totally depends on the mother. And obviously, if she, and he goes to her for soothing and comfort like that, but the mother hurting him? Oh my God. What a double betrayal, eh? How does the baby adapt to this thing? Okay, well, one strategy is he'll just become her and forget about himself. Okay, now that's a coping strategy called identification with the aggressor. So he gives up on the human side of things, really, and he's just going to function like the survival jungle slogans. And everything he does, he thinks, well, I'm surviving all the time. So there won't be empathy or feeling or trust or making amends. That quote-unquote normal, quote-unquote human side of being human, that's kind of missing. So they won't really feel or pleasure or adapt. They'll have perverse pleasure. They'll have aberrations and perversions, disturbances and sick. Like, they'll have these kind of, and they'll make excuses. They'll be cynical. Their humor is very dark. The main emotions are hate, greed, envy, grandy, spite, vindictiveness, shadow-foided, grievance collecting. Now, of course, they don't mourn, so if there are losses, okay, denial, contempt, sour grapes, didn't eat them anyway. So they're very negative like that. And, of course, there's endless entitlement. So whatever their behavior is, well, they're entitled. And they're always in self-defense mode, because they're coming from the place of the baby thinking, the memory that he thought he was a goner when the mother hurt him. So they're coming from that kind of place. So they're always thinking in terms of survival like that. And that's the model they create. That's why you have a lot of people some people call stinger personality patterns, narcissistic type, the various versions of them, the bully type, Iago type, okay, lower functioning BPD type, and some other kind of personalities. Okay, their slogans are all like that. They're all survival jungle slogans. And all they do is they can't feel, they can't make eye state, I mean feeling from the beingness. They have the sensations of anger and shame and all that. They have those sensations, visceral sensations in the survival brain. So yes, we do refer to them as feelings and emotions like that, but technically they're more like sensational kind of thing. Feelings proper are mainly the joy and sadness area. you get the tenderness and affection and love and generativity and the warmth, like that warmth area, right? The thriving and sharing kind of thing. But see, in the distant field Masada, you see the image very clearly. Pete Doctor is a soul doctor. He taught us basic emotional literacy 101 with the five characters in the first film, 2015 Inside Out. So you saw the five characters. Okay, so imagine those five characters. Okay, the first two, joy and sadness, put them together, put a circle around them, let's say. That's one group. The other three, fear, anger, disgust. Okay, another group. The first group, joy and sadness, that's related to our feeling self, or our body, the primary basic feelings that we basically have. Okay, now, if that's all frozen up with trauma, the child freezes, the soul exiles as Snow White in the coffin, Rapunzel far away, okay, and so on. All these images, this core gets pulled out. All these images, the myths of fairy tales, when a character, in a myth or a fairy tale, when there's a character that represents personification or representation or code or symbol, see, fairy tales are symbols, they're not true. They're symbols to point to something that's true, but invisible, but true. Invisible, but true, but we don't know it. So we create a symbol, but the symbol's not true, but it points you to something invisible that's true. So Snow White, okay, is not true, right? It's just a fairy tale. Okay, the image of the motif, the pattern of that character, that she's a personification of our beingness. Now look at the condition of Snow White. She's in a coma in a box in the forest. So our feelings are frozen, emotional hypothermia, emotional catatonia, emotional hypothermia, like that. Okay, in the Greek language is athymolexia. No feelings for your words anymore. No feelings for your words. You have these words, but where are your feelings? And so. And your beingness is far removed from you. That's why it's in the unconscious, like the forest. So you got your conscious, the unconscious. The forest is the unconscious, and the regular land, like the castle, house, land, that's your conscious metaphor. And the forest, dark, mysterious shadow, like that's the unconscious. You got the two lands like that. So let's quickly do the Rapunzel scene quickly here. So myths and fairy tales are true on the inside, not on the outside. Again, they're symbols, so they're not true. We treat a myth or a fairy tale kind of like how you treat a dream. They're all products, they're all productions of the primary mentation. The baby's mind at the beginning, it's primary mentation. This primary mentation, Alice describes it as, oh yeah, up is down, left is right, things are topsy-turvy, hall of mirrors, house of mirrors, things can flip and shape-shift and morph and magic this, and this can twist to that, and that could be that. Okay, the cat says, don't expect normal conscious logic here. In the primary mentation, the baby's mind is in. It's just swirling around with wild images that flip and flop and twist. And there's no time, and they're all true. No contradiction, because there's no time. Every moment is what it is. So no contradiction. That can represent that. That could be code for that. Things condense and bring it all together for a new image, because there's no time. So now you got some new image that's from different times, but there's no times. It can all be, you got condensation, displacement, flipping, and shape-shifting, and quicksilver, flip-flopping, and morphing, and twisting, and hall of mirrors, house of mirrors, man, twisting mirrors. It's all wild like that. So that's the primary process mentation, the unconscious mentation. Okay, the main thing is, the most important thing to get out of that one is that there's no time. It's timeless. When they say the gods, these images, they live immortal. Well, there's no time, forever, no time, because there's no time. That's why they say forever, because there's no time, no understanding of time, so they're forever. So the baby's in a state of timelessness. You know, these stray cats running around here, they don't have any conscious understanding of time. You know, like all they're just in the quote unquote now all the time. Yeah, be careful with that phrase, in the now. So there's the healthy way of doing, because you're enjoying the present. But there's the spaced out way, oh, I'm in the now, man. I think it maybe was set up to fail. I talked about yesterday the decision to not allow those hallucinogen things. And I quickly looked at who the leader of the thing was. I forgot his name, but I saw him speaking for a little bit. He was this spaced out hippie kind of character. Oh man, yeah, we should legalize this, man. This is the guy who's presenting this. Everyone's shaking their heads, says, oh, you gotta be kidding. So maybe it was set up to fail. I don't know, which is a good outcome, I think. So Mr. Groff, who's sort of the behind the scenes guy of it all, he Maybe he had a change of heart and set it up to fail, or maybe he thought it would get through, but then his sponsor would be just a point rolling in the grave. But his sponsor is Mr. Hoffman there, but he passed away already, so maybe Groff didn't care. I don't know what the story is. So we talked a fair bit about this this issue here, based on the documentary Hoffman's Potion. So that's very so I won't redo it here, but we spent four videos on Mr. Groff's quotes, and the conclusion is no, you're hurting a person more. You can't skip over or bypass or leapfrog over your consciousness and somehow travel back, bring up the memory that you felt and experience what you felt in the uterus. That's what they're trying to do. They want you to feel what you felt in the uterus, so you got this spaceless, ooey, wow, oceanic ecstasy feeling, this blissed out feeling. So you're just feeling what you felt in the baby but forgot. How is that helpful? You know, they make these excuses, well, when you were healthy there, right? So bring you back to the healthy place. Okay, so it doesn't work like that. You can't deny the actual events of the trauma with the mother. So you gotta identify, you need a lantern, you need a flashlight, okay, you gotta see it. You need a lasso of truth to reveal it. Yesterday we talked about these quotes being a lasso of truth. Okay, and these quotes, you need like to be a detective and be, give the scarecrow a brain, because the scarecrow, something happened, but he doesn't know it because he can't think it because he's got no brain. So you got to give the scarecrow a brain. You can't bypass this issue and pretend the scarecrow, leave him like that. No, that's your ego. To heal, you need a blade of understanding to create a nest. And when there's a nest, oh yeah, they got a nest here. Yesterday, I'll show you later. They got a nest here on the balcony. So the bird built a nest. Okay, then there can be an egg. Psychoanalysis looks for an egg in a basket or a nest that's missing. You're not gonna get that egg if there's no nest there. The bird fills, obviously, right? The bird first picks around twigs, looks for twigs and leaves and builds this nest. Then there'll be an egg. And in the egg, this new reemergence. So the image is the firebird. So one version of trauma is the baby's beingness turns to ashes. If the mother's soul, cruel like that, this soul is burned. He's, okay, his beingness is fried, ashes like that. It's just a symbol, not really, it's just to approximate the condition. Leonard Shengel has a dramatic term for it. I don't like it because it's never what he says it is, but it maybe feels as if it's like that. But no, even if it's ashes, there's still the ashes. Okay, the point is, it's never completely gone. So if you build a nest, okay, consciousness, weave a basket. Get a lasso of truth, weave a basket, have a lantern to see what's going on. Get some awareness, get some quotes, get some theories, hypotheses, approximations, be a detective. Look for clues, piece them together, put the clues together. Could it be this, could it be this? What does that remind me of? Maybe two clues lead to a better clue. Be a detective, be an existential detective, psychological detective, emotional detective. Why did the mother traumatize the baby? What's her story? Why, what was going on with her? Try to understand her motivation, her trauma, her pain, because of the pain that she had, she couldn't see the present because she transferred her pain and she saw her present constantly as her past, so she couldn't enjoy the present. So she couldn't see the child in the present because she only saw her past. That's what people do when they feel too much pain. They only see the past all the time, and the present is just still the past, basically. Although materially they understand the present is the present, but emotionally it's still the past. So it's always the past, or they transfer the past to the present. Or the mother was desperate to get love, so she thought maybe she could use the baby to brainwash the baby, make the baby so she can get loved by the baby, thinking the baby could be the mother for her. Old cunning tales, find the old cunning tales. So understand her story. So you gotta be like a basket like this, be a detective like this. So you study repetition compulsion, study transfer, study the idea of object relations theory, okay, how the baby creates a model based on interaction with the mother. Interpersonal leads to intrapsychic, so you kind of study this area. And then develop this developmental idea that the babies need a blissful oneness with the mother. Then he hatches out and slowly loses his infantile megalomania and goes through the process, what Mahler calls the separation individuation process, up until age 3, basically. So learn those kind of like phases of development. Just basically three phases, right? Birth to 4 to 5 months, and egg. Mother infant emerging, egg symbiosis, another egg. Then he hatches out of the the symbiosis, the merging, the fusion. Now he starts up its distinct self, psychologically distinct from the mother. Mother's a person, he's a person, but it's a gradual process of 4 to 5 months to age 3. And the 18 months, the first one is from birth to 4 to 5 months. Okay, he needs the paradise, the blissful oneness and all that to continue like he had in the uterus. Then at 4 to 5 months, 18 months, he's got motor skills, running around, crawling around. But he still thinks that everything belongs to him, that the mother's him. And so that's called the world is my oyster phase. He thinks everything's for him. He thinks he's a little god, a little king, and everything belongs to him. He's kind of like, a little bit like that, just an approximation. Then at 18 months he gets it. Oh my God, I'm not just spacey god like that. Everything's for me or something. No, I'm a person, others are people. Oh, okay, interesting. Well, that's great. We're all one big family. Oh, that's better. Oh, I like this. This is more reality here. I want to be in reality here. I don't mean this delusional spacey thing, this solipsistic dream thing. So he enters into the reality post 18 months. And now Voyager seeked out forth. And there's a whole called the rapprochement phase, and that's a topic right there, an important topic as well. So you got the three phase: egg, oyster, now Voyager, let's say. Egg, oyster, explorer, I guess, human explorer. So the egg and the oyster is a little god, and the post 18 months he's more like in the human area. My theory, just my own personal theory, that trauma prior 18 months leads to all the myths. That's why they got these grand giants and goddesses and demons and grand characters. And the fairy tale area, that's more down to earth, more like human. Yes, it's scary witches and all that, but it's like on the ground kind of thing. Yes, the witch can fly and all, but when you talk about myths, you got these wild gods and script. I think my guess is, now Chinner has a different theory. He thinks myths are just the broadest general representation of a pattern, and fairy tales are just localized variations of it or examples of it or more personal examples of the broader general theme. So myths just describe things in broad general terms. And fairy tales are examples of it. And you got these fairy tales which are examples of the mythological pattern. That's maybe he's right. Maybe it is like that. But so that's a major thread, myths and fairy tales. So they're metaphors for psychological trauma. They're true on the inside. They're symbols for trauma on the inside. Psychological trauma on the inside is true, but it's invisible. So we have the symbols of myths and fairy tales as code for it, kind of thing. Oh, a little luck today. Oh my God. Oh, this is a very rare treat to have this 2 days in a row with kind of knockout. Well, we talked about knockout yesterday. Actually, yesterday was a kind of a fun video for me. I was a little short on sleep, so I was kind of like careless a little bit. It dragged on a while, but it's kind of like, yeah, maybe it was kind of like taking a little glass of wine or something, not caring. I was a little in that mode, although I don't drink, so. But when you're sleep deprived, it has that little effect like that. So it was I talked a fair bit about the music area. So it's fun talking about the music. We talked about the song Knock on Wood, that Amy Stewart does a cover of that famous song from the 66 by Floyd, something Floyd guy. She's a disco diva thing, Knock on Wood. We were talking about it in the context of transference love. You meet somebody who reminds you of the mother. Oh my God, thunder, lightning, frightening, you know, trance, spellbound, whoa, knock on, oh my, what is this? Danger, oh, knock on wood, is this real? Is it real? I don't know, but be careful, knock away. We talked about the Radio Go-Go show, music show. So that was fun talking about that, yeah. Yeah, so that was not a bad video, I thought. I decided to keep it, after all. I wondered if I was going to delete it, and I played part of it back. Ah, oh, come on, it's not so bad as I thought it was, so just keep it. Actually, ironically, I started to like it, oddly enough. I didn't watch the whole thing back, I just usually watch like little snippets when I play it back. Okay, so in the healing journey, yeah, you got to get your mother's story and all this. Where were we before? We went off on a tangent. Where were we before that? Okay, so I can backtrack then. Okay, the word of the year for the by the Merriam-Webster Dictionary Company for 2023 last year was authentic. So we're all given this authentic self, this beingness, right? So Snow White and is a personification of this beingness, a symbol to represent our beingness. Now our beingness, like, come on, that's real. We have a beingness, a feeling, a sense of being at home within. That's kind of real. We all admit that. You feel comfortable at home within, and you're connected to yourself at home within. It's a comfortable kind of feeling, and your hum's there or something, or your emotional body, your feeling self, your beingness. You feel a beingness. You feel, in other words, you don't feel empty. You feel kind of comfortable with like that, unless you're called your beingness. That's invisible stuff, right? So how do we describe that? Oh, let's create a character. It can be any kind of character. So in the Snow White version, it's Snow White, right? But what's the condition of Snow White? Okay, she's frozen and distant, and there's a glass wall there. So that means we're not connected to our beingness because of the wall. You can see it like that, but there's a wall there, the glass wall. So you're separated, there's a gap there between you wanting to feel your beingness, but there's a wall there because that's a sign of trauma. Because in trauma, the baby wants to protect. The baby wants to protect his beingness. So he flash freezes it, puts it in a box like that, and sends it into the unconscious in the forest like that. So it's far away, so that means it's far away from me in the unconscious. So you don't feel conscious of your beingness because your beingness is in the unconscious. So Snow White is in the forest means that. Okay, same with Rapunzel. Okay, she's in the forest. Okay, so we live in these two worlds, this unconscious world and the conscious world. But our beingness is what we're looking for. And our beingness is our soul and all that. That's loving life and pleasure and meaning and gifts and what we're meant to have. And there's a pain to not have that. So when you get out of the pain, so you want to get back your beingness. So yeah, let's go back to Rapunzel for a sec. So you got the two worlds, the land, like the conscious and the unconscious. So in the Rapunzel one version is you got the house there and the lady was craving rampions, white radishes called Rapunzels in German. Rapunzel is a German word which means rampion, which is a white radish that resembles a carrot. So it's in the ground like that. Imagine a carrot in the ground, but the carrot is a white radish instead of a carrot. It's a white carrot, something like that, but it's a radish. Okay, it's in the ground like that. Okay, so in the land, like in the countryside, wherever, you got like a house with a little a house there, and the lady, oh, I'm starving, I feel empty. Oh, the husband, please go over the fence to the witch's garden. That's the, now you're in the unconscious, dark, scary witch there. It's dangerous, dark. Cross, hop, darling, go over the fence, hop over the fence. Go to the witch gardens. Get your lantern there and find those rampions. Okay, now they're in the ground. That means it's deep in the unconscious, buried dark, dark in the unconscious. So go, I know not whither, bring back, I know not. First, he's got to go in the dark witch's forest, unconscious. And now it's even buried, so you got a really hard work to bring up repressed material. Okay, that's aspects of yourself, okay, that got lost in that garden. So we had our beingness, our authentic self, and we sent it to the unconscious. And it got buried like that. So the husband, hop over the fence, get the rampions. So the fellow would hop over the fence, find the rampions, pull it up, okay, bring it over the fence, and then she would eat it, integrate it, accept it, re-own it, reclaim it, because it's hers, so she felt better. And she was voraciously hungry for her beingness. So that was the image. We want to make the unconscious conscious. Get the two worlds conscious. Okay, there was poverty there like that, starvation like that, and then you want to go to there's problems, in other words, in the conscious. So you want to go to the unconscious where your true qualities about yourself are there. Knowledge about yourself, what happened, ability to think, ability to make links, glimpses of who you'd be, who you'd be in love, glimpses of your true self. Everything that's true about you that you don't know. So so the symbol was, that's unknown to you. So it's in the dark, unconscious, dark witch's forest, and it's down in the ground like that. So it's really hard to get. So he found some aspects about himself and then took it over the fence. She ate it. Okay, that means make the unconscious conscious. Reclaim, re-own, resynthesize, and accept. So she ate the radishes. That means you're fully embracing and re-owning and making a part of yours. It was yours, you lost it, want to get it back. Okay, so that's the process. To go to the unconscious, make the unconscious conscious. Okay, and you just like a continuous process like that. So a variation, so that's one version of it. Another way of describing the Rapunzel story is you got, instead of the house like that, you got this castle there. Okay, but in that castle, you're representing the person. But there was poverty. They felt in debt, guilt. Okay, they felt guilty. They said, "Oh, we're such debtor." I mean, the metaphor is emotion of guilt. We feel guilty. We feel we're always in debt. We're impoverished because we're in guilt. We owe. We're in debt, guilt, pain. Okay, because you feel like that when you lose your soul. Okay, when the mother hurts the baby, he feels guilty. He couldn't save the mother. He feels guilty and pain because maybe the mother didn't want him. He feels rejected, no good, and couldn't save the mother. All this pain means. Then when you're in guilt. You think he did something wrong. He thinks he committed some kind of crime. So that's the sinner phrase, right? You know, he's not born like that. He just thought that in his attempt to make sense of the world. So the mother hurts him. He just thought, oh, I guess I'm no good. Okay, a sinner, guilty. Dad owes mother, owes mom, guilty. I'm invisible crime. What did I do wrong, mother? Oh, sorry, mother. What did I do wrong? How do I fix this? Oh, he's an infinite, timeless loop. Dead like that. So just trying to make sense. Yesterday's quote about trying to make sense. Yeah, it's a good one. Go to yesterday's one about the making sense of it all. Actually, do we have that one? Is that here? If it's not coming up, it was covered yesterday. Yeah, okay. That's a good one about just trying to make sense of it. Hold on, maybe this here. What is that? It's worth, let's see, where was it? Where's the one with the child's just trying to make sense of things? It must have been, I think it was in yesterday's one. I remember we talked about in yesterday's one. Okay, it was in yesterday's, yeah, sir, okay. But that was a good quote by Miss Dayton, yeah, Tian Dayton, good self-help author, I think. So the child's just trying to make sense of the situation. Mother's hurting him, how does he make sense of it? Well, to make sense of it, okay, well, she's got to be good for me to survive, and I'm no good, so he makes that kind of decision to make sense of it all. Fairbairn calls it the moral defense. The baby's going to make this moral decision. I'm no good, mother's good, trying to make sense of things. So he's not born like that. That's nonsense, that kind of thing. You're born like that. No, you're not born like that. You're born to be loved. You're born to be yourself. You're born to express your gifts. You're born to be an elder. You're born to feel and have empathy in the virtues and gratitude. You're born to have gratitude and regret and make amends for your mistakes. You're born to feel and learn and grow. You're born to have joy at the consulate and enjoy the present, not see the present as a replay of the past, constantly looping the past endlessly. You're not born like that. That's a symptom of a trauma like that. So you're not born to be trauma. No baby's born to be traumatized. No, he's born to be loved so he can be himself. He's not born bad like that. That's the confusion from 10,000 years ago when we made the transition from village to pillage due to the mismanagement of our discoveries of serotonin. A major topic discussed 27, 25, part 3 of 3, 48 symptoms, homotraumicus, 7.5-hour video to discuss that kind of area. So we're not born like that. It's just an accident, and we've just been looping it around. So storytellers are saying, stop the loop, hold the presses, hold the phone. We're in this negative loop here. We accidentally traumatized ourselves. Then we created a perpetuation of it. Because we created this loop and we're just looping around. And then you can see the effects of it, obviously. And it's such a short, took billions of years to create all the beautiful things. It went in 50 years. Most of the food is wrecked already. Now we're supposed to eat 3D printed food. Can you believe it? Now the vision is, well, if the food, okay, now that's not, I'm tempted to, if I start down that thread, it takes me 7.5 hours to do any kind of potential justice. It's hard to give that topic true justice, but Jesus. So we talk about Disavowed, catch Carl Sagan's clip, What If the Earth Is Unique clip, Kristen Wilson's clip. So we have some build-up material, and then the Homo Botoensis, and then there's a lot of material. It's easily a 7.5-hour video. That was done about half a year ago, so I keep referring to it. I keep thinking I'm going to try to update. I try to update it, and I bail it because it's just so much material. It's very, very emotional material. We talk about the plunder and the pillage and the prejudice and the religion being a tool of the pillage. We talk about destroying the ecology and destroying the food and all that, and breaking the biodiversity, and this issue of why 20% but 80s in poverty. Do the 20% have more guilt, so they put others more in debt, and they hand over, because the baby had to hand over his soul to his mother, and he felt like ashes, so they create around the world, SH, fill in the blank, fill in the blank, fill in the blank, fill in the blank, countries, how the US, sorry, how the fill in the blank creates SH, fill in the blank, fill in the blank. This whole topic, and we talk about the indie film, Insecurity, that one there, written as two words, in, as in what line of work are you in, and then security, two words, like I'm in retail. We're going to talk about that indie film, and oh boy, Crystal, yeah, I mentioned Crystal Wilson. So there's a lot there. The various theories on prejudice, a little bit about the propaganda. So let's just continue building our lasso of truth here. Lasso of truth. So the idea about the lasso of truth here is that we have 10,000 quotes here, and if each person finds 1 out of 10 that they like, then out of the 1,001 quotes they find, in effect, that can help bring up the truth in themselves, bring up the truth of the mother. Okay, that's, you need the truth, okay, to mourn. When you mourn, okay, then you reclaim and re-own, feel what you couldn't have felt, know what you couldn't have known. Now you're getting back yourself, healing and wholeness. Now you're more whole, hence healed, the symptoms go away, and now you're loving life, and now you have the capacities of the real self, described by Masterson in his book called The Search for the Real Self. One of our mentors, James F. Masterson. Good place to start, yeah, James F. Masterson's book, Search for the Real Self. It got withdrawn. All of his books are withdrawn. Most of the psychoanalytic books now are being burned, digitally burned or whatever. That's a real sadness. There's a real effort to preserve it. So that's a real scary thing like that. So luckily, I think I've saved and preserved the best quotes from psychoanalysis. So we have it here. So there's two ways to get it. Right here on this channel, just click the more link. So you got to take Robert Bly's advice. Read 10 minutes a day, and then do something with one of the quotes that you find that you like. Write it down, make a note of it. Why did you choose it? Free associate from it. Use it as a stepping stone or prompt to discuss with. Just do something, make a note of it, put it aside, email it to yourself, send it to somebody. Do something active with it. So 10 minutes a day. And then we have 1,000 videos here, so 10,000 quotes, so like if it's an inside a day kind of thing, each inside a day can help build that lasso of truth, meaning gradually get the ability to do what you see in the Inside Out 2 film. Inside Out 2 film, the film of the year for 2024, Inside Out film. And now that it's declared that it's the number one animated film of all time, because you see the imagery, okay, you see the symbol of what goes on invisibly when healing takes place. Now, you don't see Riley on the couch talking to somebody, so you don't see that, but you see what, theoretically, what we imagine might be taking place with him. So we talk about repression, when joy pops away the bad feelings, only wants to keep the good feelings, either or. Baby can't handle ambivalence, baby can't handle either or. Keep the good, reject the bad, that's the popping thing that she does all the time. That's called splitting and repression. So that traces back to the baby. Can't handle any confusion with the mother. Babies, breastfeeding for the baby is a question of heaven. If there's no heaven, it's hell. Baby can't do any under heaven, over hell, despite how it appears or something. He may be feeling in hell inside, maybe numbed out with endorphins or something, because the pain is too great. Okay, Emily Dickinson, there's a pain so utter, swallow stuff, that the person goes in a swoon. So the baby might be in a swoon because there's so much pain like that. So baby, breastfeeding is a question of heaven or hell. So if the mother's doing it wrong, misattuned, whatever's going on, oh, cunning tale, I can't see the present because she's still in her past. Yes, materially, she understands the babies are present in the present, but she's emotionally relating to the present as a new addition, as a continuation, replay of the infinite loop, replay of the past. So she just uses the present as some kind of mirage of her past, and she's still in her past dealing with her battle with the mother, her fight with the mother, her need to get mother's love. She's still struggling in this relentless, unreal hope with the mother all the time, and sees the present as the past, or the present is called the presenting past. So she's not present for the baby, so the baby feels unseen like this. So if the mother doesn't see the baby, it's misattuned like that. He thinks baby's in rage because of the fusion. If he's in rage, mother's in rage. Baby has this kind of what they call incorporating, like taking in kind of thing, so-called oral phase, where he's meant to receive. He doesn't have to give back, he's just got to receive like that. So if he's in that mode, well, the mother's in that mode. If he's in rage, mother's in rage. So it ends up, the baby thinks the mother, he creates an imago of the mother based on his oral rage and greed, and creates an image of the mother as a devouring monster that wants to eat him. Or it could be any kind of variation of that, the Cyclops, so the Wichuanimi character, or the Boar Queen in White Bear King Balamont, the Boar Queen, and the White Bear King in the Balamont story, the Boar Queen sees the fellow, whoop, gobbles him up, spits out his bones, and uses the bones as toothpicks. What an image, what a graphic symbol to describe the baby's feelings of rage and oral greed. He's so voraciously enraged like this. I like the Boar Queen. So the Boar Queen is a symbol for how the baby feels. Again, these scary symbols are just a point to how the baby feels around his needs not being met. Where are we here? What's that? Jeez, I'm a little absent-minded today. My goodness, that's the second time I've got off the track here. We were talking about the Boar Queen, White Bear King Balamont images. Oh yeah, heaven or hell, splitting, all right, okay. So the baby, when the baby's nursing, it's a question of heaven or hell. If the mother's doing it right, great, great, awesome, he's in heaven. His paradise continues, his Shambhala, his Shangri-La, his Nirvana, his paradise, his heaven, his Garden of Eden, his bliss, perfect oneness, he's got it. He had an uterus, it's got to continue for the first 4 to 5 months. Babies cannot have paradise lost at birth. That paradise has got to continue for 4 to 5 months. Called the mother-infant dual unity. It's just one there, and the baby thinks it's all him. Even though there is a mother, he doesn't know the mother's separate from him. He thinks everything is him. So he thinks he's a god or a king like that. Everything's for him, about him, for him, serves him. There's no sense of differentiation. Him being a person, mother's a person. But the mother has to treat the baby like a human being to get this differentiation of person to person. The mother thingifies the child, neglects the child like that, misattuned like that. He never gets out of that kind of thing. So he'll end up with narcissism, still in a solipsistic place where he thinks he's entitled to everything for him, doesn't care about the effects of others or empathy for others. That doesn't take place. The baby needs to be loved to reach that developmental place of love and empathy and I'm okay, you're okay kind of place. Okay, so if the mother is misattuned like that, he's got to cope with this situation. How is he going to cope with it? Baby's a bit of a genius. He's trying to adapt to the situation. He's trying to figure things out here. He's got to figure things out here. He'd be a goner with no mother. He's got to turn to the mother. But the mother's hurting him, not meeting his needs. He's enraged by this. He's the mother's a monster now. How is he going to cope with this? Okay, well, he tricks himself. First, to not be flooded with stress hormones, he tells the amygdala, in effect, hey, amygdala, hold up with the stress hormones here. Hey, glands, hold up with the stress hormones here. I know you mean well. I know we're in danger here, and you want me to run, and you want me to fight with the mother, but it's too much. I can't flee. Where am I going to go? I don't have motor skills. How can I run? I can't stand up and run and look for another safe place here. I can't flee. I can't flight. You know, I was thinking about that. Why, about a year ago, I referred to the Route 66. There's a scene in Route 66, the classic TV show Route 66. If you go to 2599, TQ 20 therapy code, TQ 2599, you'll find 11 quotes from that classic show. actually, some of the best quotes in her whole collection come right from there. It's the first one about the mask. That's a really touching one for me, because in that episode, the traumatized daughter grew up away and all. She tried to return to face the mother, and now she saw really what the mother was like, and she just darted out of there. And her friends who were in the car at the curb revved the engine, get out of there, so she had to flee, because she couldn't flee before. Now she was fleeing. That was a touching kind of, so that's why the baby wants to flee, the baby wants to escape, but he can't. Now then he would want to corner, so to speak, so now he's got no choice, he's got to like fight with the mother. How does the baby fight with the mother? How does a helpless, passive baby fight with the giantess in the nursery is hurting him? And she's got all the power. He's helpless. Baby's helpless. Cry, scream, flail about it. But it's not gonna hurt the mother. It's not gonna control the mother or change the mother or something. He's communicating his distress. That's true. But the mother's ignoring. He's angry. The mother's ignoring. He's very angry like this. Mother's double binding. Mother's gaslighting. Mother's baby and angry. And the mother says, "Stop! What are you angry at? Don't you hate me, baby? No, I don't hate you. Well, now I do. I didn't before. So." The baby's angry. So what ends up happening is the baby has a fantasy. Oh my God, I wish I could just gobble this woman up so I could possess it, control it, so maybe I can manage it, maybe it'll be a proper loving mother finally. So the baby has this kind of voracious, hungry wolf fantasy like that. Okay, now if he has that, the mother, he thinks the mother's that. If he feels like a quote-unquote hungry wolf, the mother's a bigger one like that. Okay, the boar queen image, right? Okay, so how does the baby survive then if he thinks his mother's a monster that wants to eat him? Okay, whoa. Okay, so, the amygdala. So, dear amygdala, stop sending me these stress hormones. I can't flee, I can't fight, I can't space out too much. So stop sending me these stress hormones. You're hurting me like this. The mammalian part of the brain says, well, what do you want me to do, baby? I'm pretty simple like this. It's in danger here. You gotta flee, you gotta flight, you gotta escape in your mind, you gotta do something here. But you're doing it too much here. Hold up here. I can't take anymore. I can't dream out anymore. I can't fantasize anymore. And I'm already a deer in the headlights thing. I can't do anymore. Like, stop sending me more adrenaline. I'm already like playing dead. Like, oh, I can't stop it, amygdala. Well, what do you want me to do? Well, I gotta trick you. What do you mean? Well, you're doing this, you mean well, I know you mean well, it's a survival thing, I know that, but you gotta see the reality. I can't do anything else anymore. I can't flee, I can't control the mother, I can't play, I can't space out and still protect myself, like leaving the mind but stay in the body and maybe my mind, I can't do anymore, like otherwise I lose my, come on, hold up here. Well, again, what do you want me to do here? Okay, well, I gotta trick you, what do you mean? Well, let's put it this way. You think I have needs. That's right. And you think that those needs are not being met. Well, obviously. And you observe that I'm enraged by this. Obviously. Well, let me trick you. What do you mean? Well, let me divert your attention. Let me let you think that I have no needs and feelings. It's the mother. What do you mean? Well, look at the image I'm creating. You see that image there? Yeah, what's that? Well, see, it's a boar queen. Oh my God, the boar queen. The cyclops. I see. So this image is enraged and has needs, not you. That's right, not me. The mother, this imago, mother. Oh, okay, so not you, it's the image. Yeah, divert your, look at the image. Oh, I see it. So the rage and the needs not being met, that's the image is freaking out like this. And not you, that's right, not me. I'm okay, everything's okay with me. It's the image, she projects it, tricks it like that. The amygdala goes, oh, I see, so you're okay, that's right, I'm okay. You're safe, that's right, I'm okay. The amygdala says, wait a minute, I'm confused here. What do you mean, amygdala? Well, if you think your mother's now a devouring monster that wants to eat you, how do you survive? How do you take in the powder stuff? I don't get it. Well, good point here. So part B is, let me hallucinate a goddess and let me let you see the goddess in my hallucination. And I'm safe and one with the blissful goddess. So now they've got the ideal breast who's loving me, and I'm safe and I'm peace. And I'm calm because I got the mother. I'm in paradise. See the amygdala? I'm in paradise. I see. So you're safe? That's right. I'm one with the goddess breast. I'm safe. It's a trick. It's a delusion. The amygdala goes, oh, okay. So you're not in danger. That's right. You're safe. That's right. Okay. So the amygdala holds off. Thank you. So that's an approximation of how the baby's trying to be. He's in defensive mode, not only from the abusive mother, you know, Mrs. Toon mother, but from his own brain system. He's in defensive mode. This is called defense mechanisms, like defense. He's in defensive mode. Mother's attacking him. His own amygdala is attacking him, kind of thing. So you got to protect himself. It's called defense mechanism, psychic defenses, maneuvers of the mind, operations of the mind, mechanisms of the mind, mental mechanisms. Lachlan has a whole book called Mental Mechanisms that lists them. Jerome Blackman has an abbreviated one, and a few others. Okay, so the baby, this defense mechanism is known as projection and splitting. Okay, so, well, his beingness is frozen, that's number one. His soul is frozen, exiled. Okay, projects his traits onto the mother, makes an imago like that, it's projection. And then he denies that, compartmentalizes that, puts that relational image of the monster and him being attacked or in danger with her, shamed by her, no good, not good enough, can't please her, can't save her, no good, always guilty, always got to owe her, suffering like this, and is attacking mother, freezes that, puts it in a separate bin, hallucinates a goddess, and he's special and loved by this goddess breast. That's the splitting one. So that's called psychic splitting. So in the template in his brain, he's got a part mother that's amazing, and he's special and chosen like this, and he's safe like this. Okay, the monster one, and he's fear like that, shame like that, that's a separate one like that. Now, if that's set in there like that, like permanently, if that's set in, if that doesn't get a chance to resolve itself in normal development, okay, see, in normal development, those split images fuse together and poof, you get a new image of a human mother that's loving and a self that's loved by this loving mother. And it's not perfect, but you can hold the confusion. You can see the two sides of the coin. Three-dimensionality, golden mean, middle, balance. The mother's loving and frustrating, and you can hold it. Okay, you were loved and hurt by her, and you can hold it. There's a kind of like a tolerance of you're okay, wounded, but you're okay. Mother's okay, but wounded, but you're okay. There's a kind of a I'm okay, you're okay kind of quality, but it's not like perfect. It's just I'm okay, you're okay like that. So that's a differentiation, so the mother, the image of the mother is a human who soothed the baby so he can be differentiated from himself. He doesn't differentiate if he's doing splitting. The goddess is not real, and the monster is hurting him, and the goddess is not real, so he doesn't get human love to differentiate. So he's dealing with these fused split images. So if that's the model in his mind, a psychic model like that, he doesn't differentiate. He doesn't have his beingness. Snow White is constantly in the forest, frozen, waiting, you know. And then Snow White might be angry or something, and Snow White sends a frog out or something. You know, I don't know. A frog might come out here. Frog, hey, come on, you. The Snow White's in the coffin here. Who are you, frog? Well, I'm a message. I live near Snow White. I see the Snow White frozen like that in the coffin and waiting for you. And I'm a friend of hers, you know, and I'm popping out here. Come on. Yeah. Okay, so the splitting mechanism. Okay, so the babies begin briefly with the splitting mechanism because no mother's perfect. So the child copes with the splitting strategy. It denies, that's how he temporarily deals with the frustrating mother. He splits it. There's my mother. No. My real mother who's hurting me, that's not my mother. This other, oh, there's my mother, and the split, they're separate. That's called splitting like that. And he doesn't, quote unquote, contaminate. He doesn't want to know any truth, because that'd be like admitting the truth. Baby can't admit the truth. If the baby were to admit the truth that the mother's hurting, he'd be a goner. He can't admit the truth. So he splits off the truth and believes the lie to survive. That's just a coping strategy. So he believes the lie for survival purposes. Okay, the truth, he can't handle the truth. Okay, famous line. He can't know the truth. Now, at midlife, you want to know the truth. At midlife, I want the truth. The truth will upset you free. So at midlife, okay, you see the broccoli boat, and then the ab reaction, things come up, and you integrate, and you get the new sense of self, inside out too. Oh yeah, we were talking about that. So in inside out too, the joy character, okay, that's, you see the splitting taking place. the joy character inside out too. I keep only the good memories. Any painful memories? No, pop it away. Pop it away. She had this tube thing where she popped it, ejected it away. So she only kept the one side and can't handle the truth, any painful memories. That's a splitting. So she had from that one side, you had a sense of self. That's like a part sense of self related to only anything that's good, imagined good, real good, or ideal good. Just only thing that's good, real or made up, whatever. Just something good. That's one side. Don't know confusion. The other side. That's psychic splitting. That's a pain. Now, in the drive for healing, there has to be integration, and the two have to come together and to create a coin. And the third side holds the two, and a new thing comes up called a coin. You don't want one side and another side, and there's no middle like that. So you gotta come together. The welds together inside Route 66, the fifth one down about the welding. The third, the coin, the middle, the third side of the coin welds the other two sides, and you got this whole thing like that. And it holds it. It's a continuous understanding. A very good quote there, Route 66. About that one. So when the joy was popping away, you see the splitting. Now, because there's this innate drive for healing, that's why anxiety pops on the scene. That anxiety represents the other side. And the anxiety's belief was, I'm never good enough, I'm never good enough. Remember, she said, I'm never good enough. And anxiety means you're always going to face the old fears. Anxiety is, I prepare for the future, she said. Meaning, in the future, you're going to be constantly reminded of the past. But this time, you're going to be prepared. And the physiology of this preparation is called anxiety. Physiological responses. She's bouncing around, imagining worst-case scenarios, drinking energy drinks all the time. She's quite funny like that, buzzing around, very hypermanic like this, trying to imagine this, trying to prepare. What if this could happen? She always thinks she's not good enough. And she always has to save the mother, redeem the mother. So she was so ambitious to be perfect, so ambitious to get the star of everything, be number one, this, number one. She was so thinking that's how she would please the mother, let the mother feel seen, and so she could be seen and be healed and then return love and like that. So she was trying to get mother's love and that in effect. But the deep belief is she's never good enough like that, because the split side of it all. Okay. Now, we don't see the mother images inside out too, but we see the self representation. So the anxiety was speaking out the self, part self, the shame side, the truer side, that she's never good enough, guilty, sin, guilty, dead, you're never good enough. So she kept saying, I'm never good enough, never good enough, I gotta try hard, never good enough. So I'm trying to compensate. It doesn't make sense. You can't redeem the mother, you can't save the mother. No success you get, no cookie you get, no pint of ice cream you get, or no status or prestige, or, you know, you buy a car, prestige, status, you know, no thing, and you advertise it, tap into this. It's not a car, it's not just a car, it's status and prestige. Oh, really? You're going to save your mother? Really? You're going to be healed by buying an expensive car? It's going to heal you? It's going to heal your trauma from the nursery? But you're hoping for that kind of thing unconsciously, right? So that's unreal kind of stuff. That's why it never works. You hear it endlessly. All these gajillionaires, they have ennui. They're sarcastic and bitter because all their efforts never work. They own 1,000 islands, or they own 1,000 buildings or whatever. 1,000 fill in the blank, whatever. 1,000 yachts or whatever. 1,000 castles. They have ennui. They have ennui, this deep sarcasm, because nothing could heal that trauma in the nursery. And no symbol, no material, no matter, no money can take it back in the time machine and morph into be the good mother that was needed back then, and give you the love that you needed back then, and correct those wirings that you can't go back in a time machine. There is time. But again, that survival brain doesn't know, that's the key point, that survival brain doesn't know time. That's why that part of the brain is often nicknamed the iguana brain, okay, or the salamander brain, or the gecko brain, or the... any one of those creatures, chameleon or whatever, or a lizard or whatever. And don't ask them for the time. They don't know what time it is. Don't discuss feelings to them. They're not feeling area. Those creatures only have the instinct to reproduce and survive. That's it. They don't have like love and feelings or family and play. Like, they don't have that kind of thing like that. You don't see. Crocodiles playing the ball or something. You know, there's no like fun. They only think about survival, reproduction. That's why that part of the brain is nicknamed the reptile brain like that. And that they don't know time like that. So if you're operating out of the flare-up of the EAS, enlarged amygdala syndrome, okay, the amygdala, and it's too inflared, it's too enlarged, and that means you got so much brain chemistry around cortisol and adrenaline make you hypervigilant, hyper-alert, and you got to plan all the time, like that anxiety character kind of thing. So you think, well, how are you going to survive? Well, you got to save the mother. You got to control the mother, or save the mother, or get a loving mother, or if you're angry at the mother, maybe she'll change. So you think you control her, she'll change. Or you find symbols of mother, and you'll get the love. And you're trying harder and harder, and each time you do it, the amygdala gets more enlarged, and it's timeless. And then, but when you do it, the allure of it all apparently is that it maintains the trauma bond to the mother. You're loyal to the trauma bond. You're loyal to the trauma, and that trauma becomes like your only attachment to mother. So now you're invested in this because that's your mother kind of thing. And you never got her love to leave her. So you can't leave her without her love. And you didn't get enough love from her to even have the capacity to kind of fix yourself to... Well, it's harder, right? It's harder. Mothers have to love their babies at least a little bit. Give them some chance to fix themselves afterwards kind of thing. But if the baby's removed from the mother, put on a scale, worse things. So yeah, yesterday I went on a bit of a rant about that point about the scale and the importance of the sacred masculine and the sacred masculine in the delivery room. No, you don't put the baby on a scale. You leave the cord, leave the placenta, lotus birth, natural birth, gentle birth, hand the baby to the bosom. Okay, no towel, no washing, leave the smells, leave the hormones, leave the continuity, leave the cord, leave the placenta, lotus birth. Okay, let the baby preserve the continuity of the paradise. And if the doctor says, no, in the name of pillage and plunder, we got to calcify your child's soul. We got to traumatize him and make his soul, give him an image in his mind. We got to create an image in your baby's brain mind of a monster. And we want him to think like that. We think the world is greed. My greed or your greed? A or B? In the name of pillage, we got to brainwash your kid. No. Sacred Mass says, you don't hurt my baby here. You're hurt if you're doing this. But I can't fix you right now. I gotta protect my baby here, kind of thing. So that's the sacred masculine too. So no, but I lose my job. I don't care about that. You don't remove the baby from the. You don't. You leave the cord. Don't sever the cord. The only time you can sever the only time they're now saying you can sever the cord is after all the blood flow has done its thing. The oxygen, the food, the nutrients, the flow. Okay. It takes a couple of days for that to cycle, to complete the cycle. When the cord, okay, turns white and it flattens out like a pancake, then that's the only time you can remove the cord. If you remove it prematurely, which is a lot of times they're doing, the child, they're doing that to make the child look for the fan. Where's my phantom placenta? I'm missing something. I'm looking for something. Constant craving. Where is it? Where is it? They do that. Oh, we found it. It's in the sky. Then they make you dependent on the need to image your phantom placenta or breast in the sky. They condense it to make it two, to describe both, to maintain the trauma, to make you unaware, to preempt healing. So that discussion about the link between trauma and prejudice, see, when you traumatize the baby, you create the prejudice mind. The prejudice personality is needed to pillage and plunder. So pillage is related to prejudice. So we talked about Mr. Bunker yesterday, Archie Bunker. An equal opportunity. Oh, a little luck here. Yeah, last. I think this is the third time I've come here where it's been kind of mellow like this. Yeah. Usually there's guests all around. I gotta bounce around, change venues, kind of thing. Let me just take a small breather here. Sorry, I can't really show you too much like this.
Well, there's the bikes.
So the baby's adapting. How does the baby adapt? How does he cope? How does he survive? Huge double bind. He can't escape. He's got to go to the mother. Mother's hurting him. He turns to the mother for soothing, but the mother hurts him. He's got to be soothed, comforted by her, but she's hurting him. How does he deal with all this? Yikes. So he does these operations of the mind. So first, he freezes up his soul, flash freezes his soul, exiles him to protect him. He wants to protect and conserve and save his soul. Imagine the frozen woolly mammoth in a block of ice like that. So it's saved like that. You want to preserve it like that. That's his real self. That's his authentic self. That's his being. That's his soul. Everything like that. All frozen to protect it, to hide it. But the mother's very abusive. In some fairy tales, to hide it from the mother, the soul is imaged in a different character. It morphs to an animal, like a wounded animal or something, or some other thing, to hide it. Like you're really trying to hide it, protect it from the mother. So it's one thing that it's in a forest like that, and it's locked away like Rapunzel and all that. But if there's more trauma, it's going to go down a tunnel, down a cavern where the light is never shown, up a mountain, down another tunnel, go to the 9th ocean, to the 27th, this and that, and then over there, this up and down. Go I know not whither and bring back I know not, says one fairy tale. Go I know not whither and bring back I know not. So our soul is very far away, and we don't remember it. We don't even know what we're looking for because we don't remember it. And it's far away like that. That's the hero's journey. Go, I know not whither, and bring back, I know not what. So go into the unconscious. Okay, just hop over the fence. Pull up the rampions. Okay, so that's a symbol that you own your projections. You look for patterns. Are you treating others negatively to finally realize that that's how your mother treated you? Aha! Get pull up the radish. Except, you know, consider, oh, I don't know, I'll put it back. No, well, that's the idea. Just question. Projection, owning your projections, withdrawing your projections, so-called shadow work, very important. Because your projections, that's your wounded soul, and you don't know it, and you say others have it. That's an intermediary kind of step to own it and claim it. So to know that it's within, you say others have it. It's like a mirror to see that it's within. So now you're getting somewhere. So when you make that click, you get it back like that. That's kind of like eating the radish, and getting it back. Okay, so the baby engages in the splitting mechanism. He may identify with the aggressor, and due to repetition compulsion, okay, you're going to replay that scene because you still have the hope for mother's love. But if you become the mother and you object yourself, you're going to be angry at her for that. But you are her. So how do you be the mother and be angry at her at the same time? Enter proxies. So in the new situation, they replay the scene because trauma and repetition compulsion are synonymous. When the baby cried for love, mother said no. Okay, that's a grooved in, seared in, she says, Dayton says, it's a seared in relational memory. Memories are relational. Baby cried for love, mother said no. That interaction is recorded in the brain. There's even a chemical, they've identified some chemical, catecholamines or something. That kind of functions like a sealer kind of thing. So it's really in there like that, Jesus. And that's a real curse. That's a real curse. In the past, they would say that's a curse because you're going to see all time based on that loop. And you're going to repeat that loop. Baby can't love life in the present. He's got so much pain fighting with the mother all the time. And that's he only understands that infinitely. So yes, materially he understands the calendar and all that, but emotionally it's still not passed like that, got split like that. Okay, listen, okay, you know, I at this point here, I normally go into the record, the repetition compulsion, Berger's theory about the record, the 45 record and all this, and the different ways it's done, the stingers and the clingers. We talk about identification with the aggressor. We talk about the trend, the double thinks area, the primary process mentation, okay, and the personality patterns related to the stinger personality patterns, and the clingers, and what the stingers do, scapegoating, and the stingers do the scapegoating, and then the clingers, you know, they can make I statements and pre-associate. And what if this clinger marries the stinger, this issue. There's a whole wealth of material. I think yesterday I covered most of that part. So let's not redo it again here today. Well, let's check the battery here. Yeah, but that's sort of the heart. That's sort of the heart of it all. That material about identification with the aggressor, repetition compulsion, repeating the past and the present. The present. It's just a new edition of the past, replay of the past. Okay, so back to Mr. Freud. Mr. Freud's famous essay, memory repeating and working through. So if we don't remember, we don't know what happened, we can't feel it, we can't know it, we repeat. The acting out is trying to remember. We're trying to remember, but we communicate it by our actions. We act it out, transference acting out. So we repeat it. We repeat it in attempt to remember. If we do finally remember, okay, ab reaction, okay, the Avalon scene in Inside Out 2, that's remembering, getting it back, feeling what you couldn't have felt, knowing what you couldn't have known, okay, now you're accepting what you couldn't have accepted. And then you stop repeating. So we repeat because we don't remember. When we remember, we stop repeating. Now the midway of all this is called working through, suffering through. That's the hero's journey, the second journey. So in effect, you know, when the characters in Inside Out 2 hop in the broccoli boat, that's kind of like the Odyssey. They're on the ocean, the river like that. Common motif. So we discussed, why don't we finish that part? So we talked about joy in Inside Out 2 popping away the negative feelings. So now you got the splitting, all good or all bad, either or like that. Anxiety hops on the scene in an attempt to bring up the other side so that ultimately the two sides can be replaced with a new third that holds the two. And that's what you saw at the conclusion. So at the conclusion, you saw the two sides. Riley says, I'm a decent kid. No, I'm a no good kid. No, I'm an all right kid. Or I'm selfish. No, I'm generous. So she had these kind of opposites kind of going on based on the splitting, kind of like either or attitudes. And I'm good, I'm no good, this kind of thing. Now you saw, and like now there's the healing issue is, you don't want to keep doing either or, like, it's idealized devalue, goddess demon, you don't heal like that, it's too much pain like that, you don't get your beingness like that. When you hold the two sides, when you understand the two sides, why the two sides are there, when you understand why you engage in splitting, why you were, that's your attempt to cope with the traumatizing, that's why you split. So now you're older, now you want to see the reality, forgive the mother for this, and see the truth that you're not guilty. It's not your job to save the mother. It's not your job to redeem the mother. It's not your job as a baby to cure the mother. So you cut yourself some slack, like you give yourself some compassion that you were just trying to understand and cope with the situation. So you were just trying to figure something out like that. You're not born bad like that, but you thought you were born bad. No, you're not born bad. You just made that belief in an attempt to understand this, to manage the situation. Somehow you just trying your best to come to terms with it somehow. Figure something out. So you realize, no, wait a minute, I'm okay. Was that yesterday? Oh, I didn't bring the coin. You know, actually I should have brought it. I didn't bring it. Okay, no, I packed it away already. You know what, yesterday, yeah, so there was some good quotes in that area. Oh, somebody just sat right beside me. Oh, jeez. Actually, that's a good spot beside me too, right? What if it's just one person? If the friend's gonna come later and start yapping, I'll have to move. Yeah. Okay, let's just keep going then. So part of the healing is your parents were people, not just parents. They're wounded. Okay, they can't see the present because of the pain they feel in the past, and for them, the present is still the past. So if the parents criticize the children, that's because they're still in the past dealing with their past. So the child just is swept in with their past drama. So they're caught in the past like that. That's part of it, right? Plus, see your parents not just as parents, just as members of this homo traumatized family. People. Okay? Like your parents, when they were babies, babies are human beings. Your parents are human beings too, you know? Your parents are human beings, right? They're not just parents. They're like persons with dreams and hopes and plans and things. Didn't pan out, Bruce Springsteen says. Go to Bruce Springsteen, Independence Day, Toronto. Listen to the introduction that he gives on YouTube. Bruce Springsteen, Independence Day, Toronto. Now, the guy who filmed it was way up in the rafters. You don't see him, but the audio is clear. You can hear. Listen to that introductory clip. That's the best introduction to a song I've ever heard. That's the best intro, right? So listen to the intro. It begins with him saying, fathers and sons. Fathers and sons. That one there. Just a short little introduction. Yeah, the song's good and all that. Actually, the best live rendition of that song, Independence Day, is the one done there. If you want to hear a good live rendition of Independence Day, he means like emotional Independence Day from the mother. Not like, see, you can have a physical Independence Day when you leave the home kind of thing. But the memory follows you everywhere you go. You're not free from that. You don't have independence from that traumatic script. So to get emotional independence, it's a different kind of thing like that. So he was talking about those two things. Doesn't seem to mind. She's probably waiting for a friend or something. Some young ladies waiting for a friend. Makes me a little self-conscious. I don't want to bother people. But see, I'm assuming something. Maybe she doesn't feel bothered, but I think maybe if I was there and someone next door was yapping on the phone, I might eventually feel tired of it or something. Actually, they do have a little, I just discovered yesterday when I was here, they do have a little balcony part, so I can go to the balcony part for a while. Okay, yesterday we talked about inside out too, so the splitting, okay, the either or like that. Now how do, now in the conclusion, when Riley was experiencing, she was facing the two sides, whereas before she was in denial all the time, right? Now she's facing more the truth of the other side, that she really felt no good, and she really felt always no good. But before she thought she was perfect, now she thought she's no good. What is it? What is it? Am I good or am I no good? Okay, no, it's something. It's something in the middle. It's called the golden mean, the middle way, the way, the middle, like that. That's more holistic or something that holds it all, like a broader kind of thing. So you're a broader like that by your sense of self. It's not this fine either or click click. Either. No, it's a broader kind of thing. So you saw the group hug. You saw the nine characters doing like a circle thing. That's the image is you're trying to hold it now. You're trying to soothe yourself and hold it like that. You're trying to accept the two sides. Woodman, back to Woodman, she calls it holding the tension of the opposites. Oh, just noticing your fancy drink there. That looks pretty good. all of my talking is bothering them. They get used to this. Sometimes I'm self-conscious when people are nearby, overhearing you kind of thing. Okay, so yesterday we mentioned the suffering through imagery. So the main process of suffering through or working through is called free association. So they showed you that with the stream of consciousness, the river there like that. Now we saw the characters lost in the unconscious. Where is it? Where is it? Where's the river? Where's the stream of consciousness? Where is their block? They were stumbling around. They couldn't find it. Okay, that's code for how difficult it is to speak the truth, to face this, to admit something, to really, really, truly free associate, to truly feel and admit something. We're resistant to it. We don't even know that we can do it. So you're stumbling around, but you need to do it. Finally, they found the stream. They saw the broccoli boat. And they didn't want to get on. Like, no, although we're closer to the truth, I really don't want to know, and I'm again resistant. And somebody said, yeah, for Riley, come on, hop on the boat for healing. Yeah, okay, for Riley, we're going to do it. Get on the boat. So now they got on the boat. Okay, now you're getting somewhere. Now you're getting to your feeling, the flow of water. Now you're free associating, and that's riding the boat back to the back of the mind called the unconscious. So that's when you free associate, say what comes to mind. Oh, this reminds me of this. Oh my God, that reminds me of that. Oh, I felt that. Now you're like moving towards reclaiming and re-owning and knowing what you couldn't have known, feeling what you couldn't have felt. So when they got to the back of the brain, you saw, then they could accept now what they couldn't accept. Because that's the case, because you free associate and have some ahas like that, and then you get the reaction, the reaction. So all those orbs came to the front, the cables to the mind, then you got the either or, the group hug, then a new sense of self. You replace the either or part sense of selves. So you saw the sense of self based on one side, sense of self based on the other side. They popped them both away to leave space for a new sense of self. And then when she got that, that's her beingness. She got back her beingness. So when you resolve the splitting, you get back your beingness. Reparation of the mother, reparation of the self. When you forgive the mother, understand the mother, you know what happened to you, then you forgive it, then you're forgiven. You have self-empathy, empathy, like this. See, that's why these quotes lead towards that. They work towards that, right? Either by giving you a lantern, bring up the truth, the lasso, the nest, the container. And when that reaction takes place, it's kind of like the phoenix flying up. Okay, so from the ashes, you got the phoenix. So that reaction is the same motif, the phoenix from the ashes. Psychoanalysis looks for an egg in a basket that's missing. When you get the egg there, there might be, in one fairy tale, the phoenix hops out. The firebird hops out of the egg. Whoa, this vibrant, colorful, vibrant, alive, fiery kind of flames like that. The protagonist hops in the back of the firebird, rides the firebird up. That's the emotional knowing. Now you're getting back your feelings. Now you're getting back your emotional body. Now you're feeling alive within, kind of thing. Then when she got back her beingness, her home within, the feeling self, the ontological self, the sense of self, then she calmed down. The anxiety, the orange mop head carrot, she took a back seat, drank some tea. Joy came back at the console. She was calmer. Her symptoms went away. Her physical issues went away. Her anxiety went away. Okay. Then she was more feelings. So with the feelings, she remembered the harm she did in the past without her feelings. So she made apologies. She apologized for how she treated her good friends. Okay. And then the coach saw that she was more mature, so she got the scholarship. And she was more of a team player. And she was more mature. And you want that kind of matureness around. That calmness. So when you're calm, you think better. You're more of a team player, you're more reasonable. So she'll be a good player. That's why she got the scholarship, right? It's too dicey to give a kid a scholarship if they're just drinking constantly 10 energy drinks every minute or whatever, and they're buzzing around like that. And maybe they can, with that manicness, score extra points. It's not sustainable. It's not going to last. It's harmful for the person. It's painful to watch a little bit, although you're a little bit excited by it, but it's not sustainable like that. So when she got back her calmness, she was more of a team player, made new friends, apologized, she was a winner. She was herself, her normal self, kind of thing. So she got back her sense of self. So we had her sense of self, we lost, I want to get it back. That's the common universal motif, monomyth. Okay, the second journey, the hero's journey, that's the common issue. Okay, we had our beingness, we lost it, want to get it back. Rapunzel's in the forest, you want her to come back. Okay, Snow White's in the forest, you want her to come back. The golden ball went down the well, you want to get the golden ball back. The golden ball represents the feelings part of it all. But it implies the beingness with the feelings. I feel there for him. The fairy tale can show both, like Rapunzel, the beingness. The Rapunzel is a metaphor for the beingness. But you have the vibrancy of the golden hair. Okay, all that golden hair. Anything gold in a fairy tale is kind of like the vibrancy of the radiance of your feelings. Like the sun radiates, so your feelings radiate, kind of thing. So the storytellers would use gold for that. So sometimes it's together. Or Iron John and the golden ball. Iron John's in a cage, the embodiment and the golden ball come together like that. By the way, it was Iron John, to free the soul, you need the key. It was locked, right? It was locked in a cage. Where's the key? Under mother's pillow. You got to identify which old cunning tale did the mother do on the baby, on the person. You got to identify which old cunning tale. Okay, how did the mother use the baby to meet her unconscious needs? In what form did she do it? Did she want the baby to parent her? Did she want the baby to... did she cast the baby into the role of herself as a baby and shame her own baby the way she had been shamed, because she's replaying what happened to her with the magic fantasy that by replaying what happened to her, maybe she'll get a better outcome for her past? Doesn't make sense. So find out the old cunning tale. And there's a whole long list of them, so that takes a lot of detective work to identify which old cunning tale. Come on, mother, ring the mother up. Which old cunning tale did you inflict on me? Come on, tell me the truth here. Lasso of truth here. She'll deny it, guilt, shame you. Those are the tricks you're doing. You're still doing those tricks on me. Still guilt tripping me, still gaslighting. Oh my God. And sidebar here, the cartoon, mothers in the bubble. Mothers know how to push your buttons because, hey, she sold them on, right? So she's in survival anxiety. She's in deep survival anxiety. She traumatized her baby to have a presence for her so she doesn't feel alone, a support for her so she doesn't feel alone. Maybe she wanted the child to be to protect her. Maybe she wanted the child to be an ally for her because she's fighting with her husband because she thinks the husband's her mother and she wants to control the husband, thinking the mother's the husband, so she used the child in this drama. Find out which old cunning tale it is. Some mothers don't even want to breastfeed because they want to use their new appearance to go to the office and tease the fellows and control the fellows to get the fellows to the office or the mother, and they ignore the baby like this. And the husband said, what are you doing? Why aren't you breastfeeding? Oh, don't worry, give him the powder stuff. And he said he sunk inside, not realizing how cold and callous, misattuned the mother would be. What a rotten, quote unquote, his words, he said, what a rotten mother you are, he said. And that was the end of their marriage. That was the starting point to the end of their marriage, when he saw how cruel he treated his child. Now, how does he intervene like that? So what can he do? What can he do, right? He said, please see a therapist. No, don't do this. Who cares about the office thing? Feed the baby, hold the baby. No, you hold the baby. Here's the bottle like that. Aren't you going to hold the baby? I don't want to hold the baby. You do it. Like this, oh my God, right? The old cunning tale. See, interview. Mother, why did you do that? Why did you do that? Well, I was in such a compulsion to get mother's love. I transferred my refusing mother onto the fellows at the office, and I thought with my new sexy appearance I could control them because they were all gaga. I noticed they were all gaga staring at me, right? So I thought I could have power now. Seduction is power. Seduction is power for women. So I thought with this power, I can have power over them. With the power, I can control them. If I control them, that's like controlling my mother. Now, if I control my mother, i.e. control the fellows who I see as a reincarnation of my mother, then maybe I'll get mother's love. Mother, you're psychotic. The fellows are not your mother in the nursery here. So that's the power of the unconscious, being the puppet master, pulling our strings, and we're not aware of it. She doesn't seem to mind, though. Just staring on her phone or something. that's still got to use this arrangement here. Unless I move outside. Or, why don't I jump into the quotes? Maybe that'll keep my attention on the quotes here. Let's double check the battery. Let's see, hold on. All right, battery's holding up here. Okay, good, good. All right. I've got a very moody battery. I have to, like, the battery on the phone, I have to use this backup thing all the time. I'm using a very simple, basic, someone called it a kid's phone, can you believe it? It's very simple, really. They don't even make them anymore. It's a very simple, very basic. But it's been working pretty well, so I'll just stick with it. Yeah, it's okay. Where are we here? Rapunzel. Make the unconscious conscious. Splitting. Or Inside Out 2. So for a greater discussion on Inside Out 2, yesterday we... Well, the truth is, 2840 was my first go at interpreting Inside Out 2. 2840. I spent 3 hours. I stumbled it around. That was my first take on it. But I thought I did okay, generally. We discussed all the 9 emotions as well. I didn't do too much on ennui. So there's a separate 3-video run on ennui recently done. So when you go to 20, if you go to 2840, you'll hear a discussion about the other emotions. But I missed the one about ennui. But I picked up on it maybe 2 weeks ago on ennui. But then from 2840 till present, I've been referring to Inside Out 2 bit by bit, so it's kind of scattered like that. But it starts at 2840 if you want the world's only psychoanalytic interpretation of Inside Out 2. You see the imagery of the healing processes. So free association, God on the boat. Okay, then you got to a place where you can accept and feel what you couldn't feel. That's called abreaction, purification. Okay, this cleansing, this release, like that. Oh, I can feel it. Okay, because it's painful to always keep it down like this. You want to accept it. You want to admit it. You want to truth will upset you free kind of thing. Okay, play the Jim Carrey scene. You know, the truth will upset you free. It's all so excited, right? It was interesting little juxtaposition there. The lady was a liar all the time. But when she was compelled to tell the truth, she won the case. So he took that for his personal discovery that when anybody is truthful, they feel emotional freedom like that. Yesterday's quote about the truth, when you speak the truth, you're kind of like creating your story a little bit, right? You're on a story. The more story you have about yourself, the more you accept yourself, then you're more whole, hence healed. Now, if you're lying, you're maintaining the fragmentation, you're maintaining the repression, you're maintaining the tricks and denial, the trauma, your loyalty to the mother when you're lying like that. So you're hurting yourself when you're lying like that, right? So the idea is to move towards the truth will upset you free. Play the Jim Carrey scene. So yesterday's quote, yeah, from the propaganda batch of quotes about that. If people only knew the importance of telling the truth and how it makes them more of a person as they do so, and if people realize the effects on their personhood when they lie all the time, if people only knew, he said, if people only knew, he said, interesting quote, yeah. So part of the self-awareness and all this is identifying where along the developmental timeline did the person get frozen. Was it before 18 months? Was it before 4 to 5 months? Was it at birth? Was it in the prenatal time? Or was it between 18 months and 36 months? It's not a perfect theory, but it gives you a little bit of a orientation. Because if the trauma is before 18 months, there's going to be identification with the aggressor, and you're going to treat others as proxies of you, and you shame because your mother shamed yourself. Too painful to be the mother shaming you, so you find proxies to play you, and since others are you crying for love, and you're replaying how you cried for love, mother shamed you, now you're the mother who says no to you. To avoid the pain of it, you believe the other is you, so you say no to them with your dark humor, shaming humor. That's how you replay the record. You replay the loop. At the same time, you are angry at the mother, even though you are her. So flip-flop, hocus-pocus, the one you just shamed who played you, you suddenly see as your mother who hurt you. Now you continue your struggle with her to control her, to thinking you can control the breast so you can get the mother's love like that. So all of these kind of repeatings, okay, is an attempt to remember. Once we remember every action, okay, we stop repeating. We want to get out of this infinite loop like this. It's like a real curse like this. So you don't want babies to be cursed like this. So that's the sacred masculine. No, gynecologist, you don't traumatize my baby and give him a burned-in trauma loop in his brain. No, you protect that kind of thing. Babies need love. Babies are human beings. Babies have a right to have paradise with their mother. Don't remove the paradise from his mother. Babies need an extended paradise. I'm sorry you didn't get it yourself, and you doing this is maybe your attempt to communicate that you didn't get it, but for now I gotta protect my baby here, and maybe it'll help you to see that, so you can know that you didn't get your paradise, because I'm gonna be the sacred masculine and says no, we don't repeat this thing, okay? So hand the baby directly to the mother, or I'll do it kind of thing. Leave the smells, don't remove the baby. Okay, so there's a whole body material about the birthing time. Discussed also yesterday. Yeah. Okay, let's just take a short breather here and we'll come back to the quotes here. Hold on a second. Okay, it's 40-something here with the heat index. I've only got like 5 minutes out here before I start sweating. My God. Oh, it's another scorcher. Doesn't look like it, but it's in the high 30s. But with the heat index, it's in the low 40s. There's the nest, yeah. Yeah, see? See, the bird built the nest first, then there can be an egg. So we gotta build a nest first. So these quotes here are to build a nest, then there can be an egg. Kind of like how you need a catcher's mitt if you're gonna catch the ball down, barreling down home plate, Major League Baseball. Yeah, I was here yesterday. Yeah, I was at this very spot yesterday night, yeah. Well, that young lady's just daydreaming on her iPhone or reading something on the iPhone or something. So I'm not sure what she's doing, waiting for somebody or something. Maybe it's just an escape for her, maybe she just wants to escape or something. Oh, there's another nest. Oh, look, oh, there's two of them. I just found this out. Yeah, there's another one. See, the bird first builds a nest, and then there can be an egg. You can't bypass the nest. Some people want to bypass it, like the Hoffman's potion area. They want to bypass it. You can't bypass. You try to bypass that, bring up the forced app reaction, and you don't have a nest for it, it can create holes in your psyche, and the person, it could damage the mind like that. So it's very, so I think, from what I, as I understand, it's a good result that they said no to that kind of thing. All right, let's go back in. Oh my God. Whew. Jeez. Thank you.
such discipline.
They have to just move here. No, I don't want to bother the staff there. All right. Either I bother the guest or the staff. Huh? Well, they gave her a bit of a break. I don't know if that's... Okay, let's jump into today's quotes. Yeah, I just discovered this author, Tian Dayton, a PhD. So she's not a shrink, but she does talk a lot about transference and repetition compulsion. She's very aware of that kind of thing. And I want to entertain her. She's a follower of Moreno, Mr. Moreno. She treats Moreno and Montessori sort of in the same camp with for Mr. Freud like that. So he's the guy that created psychodrama. So I'm going to slowly see if I can look more into that kind of thing. She thinks it's like basically a replay of the old ancient Greek dramas, yesterday's quote. Okay, let's not do the psychodrama topic here. So we'll do some sort of just some basic self-help kind of topics. She's a good bridge between regular psychology, like self-help psychology. Oh, she got a call and left. Oh, she was just waiting for somebody. She's gone. Okay, I think she's gone. Okay, a bridge between self-help kind of books and a psychoanalytic perspective. It's a little bridge like Janoff is good like that. By the way, a very good place to start with our collection are the Janoff quotes, 2745-70, 26 videos. Actually, there's a bit of a kind of a continuity this year, 2024, with the quotes. We began with the Janoff batch, the follow-up with the clarification of abreaction, the supplement from 71 to 3, and then the BPD amalgam led to that, led to ennui, inside out, to anxiety, topic, Henry Hart's summary quotes. Oh, geez. A little bit about the Dionysian thing because of the Olympics. So analyze this, that one. Anyways, 2745-70, Arthur Janoff. Minus, I don't include the so-called tricks to bring up your... The regression tricks. Minus that side of it. He's got two areas there. So I'm talking about the educational side of it. Because if you have the educational side of it, you may be a little bit able to be willing to interpret your dreams more. So it may bring up more dreams like that. Now, the idea that you can force up your old dream world and try to interpret it, that's not going to happen if you ignore your regular mundane dreams in the morning like that. In other words, if people don't analyze their own basic dreams in the morning, like you wake up in the morning, got little snippets, that's like a letter from you to you, your unconscious to you. And it's saying to you, it's like this in your soul today, like help, it's this, analyze this kind of thing, right? So it's a letter from you to you, from your unconscious to your conscious, wanting your conscious to accept and admit and know and be seen. It's your wounded, it's you as a wounded inner child. It's the memory of you being hurt as a baby. These little things are coming up to your consciousness. So it's like getting a letter from that world. Okay, the image is Hermes flies across with a message from the gods like that, okay? The mythological world, the imagery, mythology of gods. So you get a letter from Santa, so if you get a letter from God, don't you want to read it, kind of thing. So it's a letter like that. Dreams that you don't analyze are like unopened letters kind of thing. So you got these dream sequences. It's like this in your soul today. So you say that to yourself. Sanford said, it's like this in my soul today. So it's revealing to you something about you. Maybe you're trying to feel what you couldn't have felt. Maybe it's trying to show you a pattern of yours. Maybe it's trying to show you how your fantasies relate to your psychic structure of what you need for homeostasis based on your repetition compulsion. What are you repeating? It's showing you what are repeating. Give a theme like that. So TTAQ, give the dream a title, theme, A for affect, Q for question. It's like this in my soul today. Then you take a snippet of the dream and pre-associate. Okay. What does this remind me of? And add a little more to it. You're making more to your conscious. Make the unconscious conscious. If a person doesn't want to do that, and you want to bring up more in a lucid thing, and don't analyze that, it's going to flood. It's too much. So I think yesterday's announcement that they're going to block that, I think it was a good one. You're better off just teaching people to help them analyze their dreams. So the solution, I think Pete Doctor, at the same time, Pete Doctor announced a spin-off show from the Inside Out 2 series. He's gonna do a TV series spin-off of Inside Out 2 called Dream Productions. Never been done before. It'll be very good. I really hope I can see the episode so I can give you one take on it. I want to see them and talk about it as well. So in the dream world, there's no time, there's displacement, condensation, everything's true. No contradiction, there's no time. So it's a message, it's a healing message to you. Hey, it's like this in your soul today. Can you be conscious of it? Can you admit it? Can you recognize it? Oh my God. Okay, now I know more about myself. Now you're accepting yourself. Oh, she did a drink or drink. Yeah. What is that drink? What is it? Which drink is that? No, what kind of drink is that? It's like a green drink. I'm just speaking English. I was just asking her what is she had like a green. The lady had a vegetable drink. Maybe like it's like a spinachy kind of vegetable juice kind of thing. I was thinking maybe next time I'll order that green juice instead of the coffee. Where are we? Oh, Dream Productions. Oh yeah, so Tianne Dayton is a little bit like Janoff in the sense that she's got a PhD in psychology. And she studied with Moreno's daughter, hence the psychodrama area. So yesterday I mentioned a little bit. Okay, so from what I can find, from what I can access, she's got like a dozen books. So these are from some of the older ones that are around. So let's begin here. A little bit about grief. And one about transference love. So it's a light load. So that's a relief. So today, tomorrow, and the next day, the next three, it's a light load. Whenever I do self-help authors, it's a breather for me. It's a light load because they write clear. It's a light load. So these three we're doing now. It's a lighter load. Gives me a break as well. So roughly 10% of the quotes come from self-help authors like Miss Dayton here. Well, again with us, they're playing the same looped set loop. It's like an hour, same songs on an hour loop basically. And this is a cover of the Bee Gees song. I'm gonna hear it again and again kind of thing. It gets me, it's a little too much, huh? Okay, I wish they'd change that loop once in a while. Okay. Clients. Clients seem to need to go through a process of active grieving of early childhood losses in order to be able to move into adult roles. Again, clients seem to need to go through a process of active grieving. Okay, the truth will upset you free. We have to admit the loss. That was a loss. Identify the loss. Okay, not being properly loved, that's a loss. You lost not getting properly loved. That's a loss. All the time. Being dysfunctional. Huge loss. Lots of losses. Who you'd be had you been loved, properly loved. That's a loss, not being who you were meant to be. All these losses. The process of grieving. Okay. We need to do this in order to move into adult roles. Otherwise, you're still an emotional child. Being angry at the time with entitlement and grievance collecting. If they do not go through this, and if they remain locked in the pain associated with early loss, they unconsciously have such a strong yearning for the original lost object, person, or experience. Okay, that's pathological nostalgia. Still looking relentlessly for this unreal hope for the fulfillment of old unfulfilled needs. You're still looking for that mother's love. Strong yearning for the original lost object. That they spend much of their time hoping and wishing and trying to make their present day adult situations into relationships that will give them what they lost, which of course is not possible. So therefore, they move through cycles of excitement and disappointment, disillusionment, and abandonment of their endeavor that closely mirror their earlier experience. So let's enter Bergman's line about the drinking thing. Okay, we got to preface it with Emily Dickinson. A great hope fell. He heard no noise. The wreckage was within. Oh, cunning tale that let no witness. Baby had a great hope to be comforted and soothed and seen and loved by the mother. Get his needs met with the mother. Have a positive relationship with the mother. Have the experience that he can treat himself in a nice way the way his mother treated him nicely. He needs this. He needs the mother to soothe him so he can soothe himself. If the baby's distressed and the mother's hurting him, how does he soothe himself? He's got to learn how to soothe himself. He learns it if the mother soothes him. Baby had a great hope for these basic things. It fell. It fell. You heard no noise? The wreckage. The wreckage. Okay, so the soul is in ashes, or the soul's exiled, or the soul is a wounded animal in the forest, or locked in a tower, or frozen in a cave. Whatever, this motif can be presented in an infinite number of ways. It's not really about that. The psychological message is the same. Our soul, mother didn't accept our beingness. Mother didn't accept that we had needs and feelings, and she didn't meet them. She didn't accept it. So it's exiled like that. It's removed from us some way or another. A great hope fell. You heard no noise. The wreckage was within. Okay, the soul is frozen, petrified, turned to stone, okay, freezing, etc. Oh, cunning tale. Oh, cunning tale. What a oh, cunning tale. What's going on with the mother? Why didn't the mother love the baby? What a oh, cunning tale. What a mysterious, cunning tale on the mother's end. What a clandestine, covert thing the mother's doing to use the baby to meet her needs. To, take her frustration on her husband and punish the baby to discharge her, displace her tension onto the child, dump on the child because she doesn't want to get angry at the husband, so she takes it on the kid like that. Old cunning tale. Wants the child to be naughty so she can have the excuse later on to say, oh, look at this naughty child. I better discipline this child. Spare the rod. So she creates an opportunity to have the excuse to blow off steam with the slogan, spare the rod. So she deliberately unloves the child to make him naughty so he be naughty, then she can say, look how naughty he is. I'm in the right to discipline him, spare the rod. So, oh, cunning tail. Okay, so she's dumping on the child like this, or and so on. But let no witness him. The child can't know it. That's the scarecrow. He can't know it. Unthought known. He can't think it, no brain. Unthought known. Let no witness him. Okay, a great hope fell. Baby had a great hope. It fell. Okay, so that's a pattern. That's a prototype in the brain. Baby had an anticipation with the mother. A great hope, a jocose, a very excitement like this. Expected that. Okay, no. Disappointed. Sad. Okay, it's going to be sad. Okay. Morose. Okay, anger is going to be there. What happened? Come on. All this pain, the brain sends some endorphins, the swoon. Berkeley calls it the comatose, the hangover kind of thing. Okay, so imagine that as a prototype. Baby crying for love, is happy like that, excited like that, sad because of disappointment, angry, and then the pain he's numbed over. Okay, how do you replay that? How do you repeat that? How do you symbolically do that again and again and again and again? How do you repeat that hoping to get a better outcome, hoping to get the needed outcome, hoping to get the proper outcome because there's no time? So how do you replay that? Now there is time, so how do you replay that? So in the present, all you can do is find something and distort and make believe that it's your mother in the past. Okay, so the burglar, one example is the booze thing. So the guy runs to the beer store all excited, thinking that the bottle of wine or something is going to be this stimulating sweet fluid. That'll approximate, that'll be analogous to or symbolize or represent, be a symbol for the missing, stimulating, warm, sweet milk that he didn't get with the mother. Didn't get it. So how do you reach for that? He didn't get it. He's got to hope for that. Wait a minute, he'll do it himself now. I'm going to take charge here. I'll run to the beer store, buy the wine. Okay, it's even called sweet wine or something. The wine will even be advertised in a veiled way that it's like that, right? So he has a great hope. Jocose, excited like that. Dopamine for the chase. Joke, he's all excited. So dopamine, anticipation, it motivates you because you think when you get it, you're going to get the love. So you're excited like that. So jocose, great hope. So the guy runs to the beer store like this, looks at the sweet wines or something, dessert wines. Oh, there's some nice dessert sweet wine or whatever. Okay, this is great. Okay, now he's excited. Now he may get a little bit of jocose and excitement because the sugar tricks the mammalian part of the brain into perceiving the person is safe by the concentrated sugar, i.e. food. Food means safety. Brain thinks, oh, you're safe. Food, so when you're safe, you get serotonin. So for a little while, you get a little blip of the excitement. That's the jocose. So you're trying to get mother's love. Of course, it fails. No glass of wine is the mother's breast milk in the past. You can't go back in the time machine and convert the wine to the milk. Like, it doesn't work. But you don't know that you're still in that issue of repeating it. Because when you repeat it, you have beliefs around it to make you unaware of why you're repeating it. But the pain creates those beliefs. And those beliefs make you unaware of the pain that created those beliefs. See, like that. So you reenact, you symbolically reenact it. So you distort the reality and make some excuses to make you unaware. Because it's too embarrassing to admit it. So how are you going to repeat it if you admit the truth? So you don't admit the truth. Oh, no, psychobabble nonsense. What are you talking about? It's for grapes. So you make some excuse that sounds reasonable. Okay, so so the person drinks the thing, disappointed, now he's sad. Oh, I'm sad, didn't work. Now bellicose, he might be angry. So the guy at the bar might be shouting or something. He's angry, didn't work. Next morning gets the hangover, it's the comatose. So the burglar borrowed this from the alcoholic community. Jocose, morose, bellicose, comatose. That repeats and replays the original prototype with the mother. Okay, disappointed with the mother. Baby was excited, jocose, disappointed, sad, angry. Okay, and then the swoon, the endorphins. He's repeating it. The burglar does another one in that area with the slot machine. So the baby regarded the mother as thingifying him. So she's a thing. If she makes the baby a thing, the baby thinks the mother's a thing. Mother refused him. She's cold like that. So how do you symbolize this? How do you symbolize the cold rejection by the mother? where the baby felt thingified and thinks the mother's a thing. Well, run to the slot machine. There's a thing. There, it's cold. It's promising. It's alluring. A great hope. Put your money in. Put your hope. Pull the lever. Click, click. Disappointed. Oh. You're sad. Okay, the way you were sad originally. Okay, so you repeated it. Okay, so that's for you to know. Okay, that you're letting yourself know that your mother was cold and refusing, because you chose a cold and refusing thing to symbolize, to know that your mother was cold and refusing. So you repeat to remember. When you remember, you stop repeating. If you don't remember, if you don't believe it, you don't admit it, you're going to keep on repeating, repeating, repeating with this relentless hope. So you put your coin in, oh, disappointed, coin in disappointment. And the machines are alluring. They tell you, oh, you might win the jackpot, you might win this, you might win this. It's alluring, it's promising, because the mother was promising and alluring, so they stimulate, they resemble that. They make the slot machine resemble the breast mother. Alluring, promising, oh yeah, keep trying, you'll get it, you'll get it. Intermittently, now you're getting into intermittent reinforcement, like once in a while, a little bit, and now, like the pigeon, you know, you do it again. Oh, I forgot that's the waitress that doesn't speak English. I forgot. So some of them speak English very well. A couple of them. To me, just like helpers and things. Kitchen help. Nice place, nice people, nice people. I gotta admit, you know. There's, I was saying in a previous video, there's a kind of a basic decency with people around here. Like there's people are generally nice. They're nice. It's a combination of the weather, family tradition, and maybe the practice of mindfulness and the practice of staying present with yourself, accepting your feelings, and having a discipline to accept your feelings and stay with your feelings. So a lot of people have a certain kind of beingness quality to them, so that's they're calmer like that, right? So they're not manic or something, right? I don't know. I'm still kind of we don't have a thread on mindfulness and meditation, that kind of thing. But Karen Horn, I concluded that that's the way to go, she said. She studied psychoanalysis her whole life, and towards the end, she was getting into this area. There's another one like that too. Who was it? Again, clients seem to need to go through a process of active grieving of early childhood losses. You got to admit your losses in childhood. You got to admit that as a child you had these needs and it wasn't met. That's a loss. It's supposed to be there. It's absent. It's not like you had your loss. You never got it. You're supposed to get it. That's a loss. Not having a loving mother in your life. That's a loss. Not having a father around or something. That's a loss. Like, come on. Not having a kind of supporter. Community or something, or educational opportunities or something. That's a loss or something, right? So, in order to be in the present, you gotta admit the loss. All of the joy for which you pray is 100 tears away, sings Vonda Shepherd in her song called 100 Tears Away. So, to resume development, to lift the anchor on the arrested development, that's like lifting the anchor on the arrested development. The child is developing to allow the beingness in the person, but it's frozen. That's arrested development, stunted development, developmental rest, stunted like an anchor, like stuck like that. Okay, one image is the thorn in the Kirikou and the Sorceress, in the kids' animated film called Kirikou and the Sorceress. There's a scene there of the thorn, and when that was pulled out, the person had they grieved, they mourned, they had reaction, they're free now, and you saw her relax. So actually, that motif is the same thing with Riley. When the avalanche scene, and she calmed down, same thing. That lady was all upset, and she had the thorn pulled, she was calmer like that. And to get to that, and to get to that place, to admit it, it's called free association. Finding your patterns, free associating, finding your patterns, admitting that the parents were wounded, admitting that they didn't mourn. And that's a loss for you, that your parents didn't mourn. That the parents were in, quote unquote, over their heads or something. Clients seem to need to go through a process of active grieving of early childhood losses in order to be able to move into adult roles, to be in the present, to match their emotional age or their biological age, right? If they don't go through this, and if they remain locked in the pain associated with early loss, if you're still in the pain of that early loss, you can't enjoy the present. You're afraid to enjoy the present. You're afraid to see the present. You're afraid to trust, love in the present. You're afraid to make I statements or admit something in the present. The pain keeps you in the past emotionally. All time is that time. The present is still the past, or the present is called the presenting past. However, they unconscious. Yeah. So if they don't mourn and remain locked in the pain of the early loss, they unconsciously have such a strong yearning. That's the hope for the fulfillment of old unfulfilled needs. You still have this hope. So the guy pulling the machine on the slot machine thing, that's this hope. Mother, are you going to love me? Click, click. Oh, yeah, you were alluring. You were promising. Oh, you still have the hope. So the wine and the slot machine thing, these are hopes for mother's milk, mother's comfort, mother's soothing, mother's warmth and presence. These are hope for this maternal supply. You reject it. So you still have the hope. You're still stuck in the past, it's the pain of the past. So people who smoke and emotionally eat and do this, they're still in the past like this. Advertisers don't want to tell you that, of course. They want to make money from you because they have the hope to siphon the money from you, from your false. And they think, well, since you're looking, then we're supplying it for you, kind of thing. Yesterday's quote about that. Again, so, and if they remain locked in the pain associated with early loss, they unconsciously have such a strong yearning for the original lost object, i.e. the breast, basically. The first mother is the breast mother. That they spend much of the time hoping, wishing, and trying to make their present-day situations hoping to make their present-day situations to give them what they lost, which of course is impossible. Nothing in the present is the past. I mean, nothing in the present is... The present isn't the past. So, the cycle. What's the cycle? Excitement, hope, right? Maybe I'd hope for mother's love, a great hope fell. That fell is disappointment, disillusionment. Their access to adult roles is blocked because they are stuck in the unfinished business associated with the child roles. These are wounds that can go unattended to. Oops. These are wounds that can go unattended in our need to get on with life. So these wounds are keeping us stuck in the past. So we can't love in the present, can't live in the present, can't enjoy the present, like our parents. Your parents, most parents couldn't do that because their wounds kept them stuck in the past. So they couldn't get on with life, kind of thing. We seem to see feelings of grief. Oh, next part here. Okay. Here's a good line. We seem to see feelings of grief as a sign of weakness rather than strength. Now look at that. So the sting of personality patterns. Reject this area of feelings and grieving and needs. Oh, grow up, come on, get over it. All these songs, yeah, play the song, get over it. So they thought, the mother said that to them. They've identified with the aggressor. When someone mocks and shames somebody's vulnerability, okay, that's code that when they were vulnerable, mother mocked them and shamed them. They've identified with the aggressor. That's how you make the inference of what happened to you, because you've identified with the aggressor. And you're treating others the way your mother treated you. So that lyricist who created that obnoxious song, musically it sounds okay, I guess, but I never listened to it. But anyways, it's an angry kind of bitter, it's an angry, crude song, right? Are you going to be vulnerable? You're going to show feelings like that? He's angry like that. Well, he identified the aggressor. He's imitating the mother. The mother was angry when the baby was crying, had needs. Mother was angry. Oh, get over it, baby. Get over it, baby. Identifies with that voice. Anybody in the present complains about something? Oh, yeah, they're very angry like that. That's code for them to know how their mother treated them, because they've identified the aggressor, because that's what takes place when there's too much trauma. To cope with the pain of it, you identify with the aggressor to have the chance to minimize the pain of the memory of mother hurting you. If you are the mother who hurts yourself, because if you're the mother who hurts yourself, you then find proxies in your fantasy to make the proxy think, you makes you think that that's you. Right? So you shame yourself, but you shame the proxy to externalize the pain that you feel and distract you from the pain you feel when you see someone else express proxy feel. Proxy means someone who feels for you, does something for you, etc. So if the proxy is in pain, that distracts you from you being in pain, and your attention is out like that. Externalized living, they call it positive. Again, we seem to see feelings of grief. Oh, that was a long time ago. Get over it. Come on, you're an adult now. Snap out of it. Pull up your boots. All these slogans that we constantly hear, right? It's just a shame on the people's feeling pain. You're shaming people for their tender, real feelings that they never had a chance to address. Where's the compassion? So you don't have compassion for yourself, you don't have compassion for others. So the person saying they never received compassion on their end, they got to give it to themselves. By forgiving the mother, and the mother said that to the baby. Oh, baby, get over it. Stop crying. What do you want? Leave me alone. I don't know what you want. Where are we here? Sorry. We seem to see feelings of grief as a sign of weakness rather than strength. In fact, true grieving requires a strong ego. True grieving requires a strong ego. That's why we have these quotes, to build the ego, to strengthen the ego, to enhance the ego, so you can grieve. Okay. So in order to grieve, you gotta give the scarecrow a brain. This is giving the scarecrow a brain, these quotes. In order to grieve, the scarecrow first has to get a brain. If the scarecrow doesn't have a brain, you're not gonna grieve, because there's no nest for the egg, back to the nest of the egg. Requires a strong ego, and at the same time, grieving builds your ego, because it asks you to stand beside your own pain, and it allows you to have it. So you have your pain, and you observe having your pain, you accept having your pain while you're observing having your pain, and you accept yourself having the pain while you're observing it. You observing it is the nest, and the feeling is the feelings release. It asks us to be strong and compassionate and wise enough to hold on, to hold our own woundedness, to hold our own woundedness in our hearts without abandoning ourselves at this very crucial moment. Okay, again, it asks us to be strong and compassionate and wise enough to hold our own woundedness in our hearts without abandoning ourselves at this very crucial moment. Now, there's nothing weak about all this. There's nothing weak about this. So grieving, you need to be strong. People who reject that, that's the weak, quote unquote, weakness, right? It's not weakness, it's just woundedness. It's just fear and woundedness, right? That's not a bad one here. The second one. That's the key one, I think. So if we abandon ourselves, you see, that's code that the mother abandoned us. Mother, where are you? Mother, I'm busy. She abandoned us. And we abandon ourselves. The way the mother treats us, we treat ourselves. We internalize that. So if the mother was emotionally absent, she abandoned us. Play the song, "If You Will Leave Me, I'll Find Somebody Who Will" by Warren Zevon. It's a short 45 second song called that. And in the song, the guy is saying that when he was a child, his mother emotionally wasn't around for him. She abandoned him emotionally. So he repeats it. He identifies women whom he sees will abandon him, or whom he can coax into abandoning him, make it happen, self-fulfilling prophecies. He only sees women who's going to abandon him, because he only sees the past of mother abandoning him. Him constantly seeing it that way puts a pressure or a pull to induce the behavior of that. So it's self-fulfilling prophecy, because he's stuck at that place. I know you're going to abandon me. I know it's going to happen. I'm just waiting for it. Come on, do it. And you might push him to do it. Why don't you do it? Come on, do it. You're going to leave me. If you don't leave me, I'll find someone who will. One woman said, "You know what? Imagine that. I'm going to stay for you." He freaked out. That breaks the script. He didn't mourn what had happened to accept that kind of thing. So he left her to go back to finding women who will leave him, because he's stuck with that template. So he couldn't accept something new, because that's his only strategy he knows to deal with the battle with the mother in the present. He couldn't accept something new in the present like that. So "If You Won't Leave Me, I'll Find Somebody Who Will." Very good song. It's on our soundtrack. Yeah. Look up Warren Zevon. Z-E-B as in Victor, O-N as in Nancy, the singer. He was commissioned to do the theme song. That song was going to be the theme song for a sequel to Route 66, which never got made, really. I think they did a pilot or something. It wasn't very good or something. So they gave up on it. But they kept the theme song. That's one of the best TV show theme songs. In my humble opinion, all my favorite. That's one of my favorite TV show theme songs, is that one there. Another one is "Death to the Defense," boom, boom, the bass drums. Barney Miller's okay. KRP, that's okay. What am I missing? We have one quote from the Barney Miller show, yeah. One guy was having marriage problems, and his friend said to him, "Marriage is like a horse, the horse with a broken leg. You can shoot it, but that don't fix the horse." He said, "Oh my God," and that saved the marriage. He was going to get divorced, right? Another example about the abandonment issue is the TV show I Love Huckabees, a comedy show. I don't really recommend it too much, but there is a good scene in there where the three helpers were trying to help this guy, Albert, the protagonist. And the three helpers, they were kind of like family therapists, but they didn't want to be referred to as therapists. Except they were like proud of themselves. They said, "Don't call me that. I'm an existential detective." So they were helping Albert. So they took him to the home. And see, here it is. You have this pattern of betraying yourself. And you learned it here in this home. They showed you the home scene. And that's why you encrypt the truth. You abandon yourself. You lie to yourself. You hide from yourself. You abandon yourself, you encrypt the truth, you betray yourself. Because your mother betrayed you, you saw it here, you learned it here, you have this pattern, and that's why you encrypt the truth. You repeat the pattern. So if the mother abandoned the baby, he'll abandon himself. And because he was always abandoning himself, he would give up easily and wouldn't be successful in all this. If we do not grieve, we build walls around the ungrieved wound, in order to protect it, even though these walls can keep healing experiences out as well. Yeah, so the lady who said to the singer, I'm not gonna leave you, I'm here for you. He put a wall there, so he rejected her. If you won't leave me, I'll leave you and then find somebody who will leave me. So he had a real wall there in that song, right? If we don't grieve, we build walls around the ungrieved wound. That sees protect the pain there, right? He doesn't want to touch that pain. He's got a wall there. Now, if she's going to offer love like that, he's got to drop his guard, so to speak. He's got to trust her, but he's got so much classical conditioning. Trust? You kidding? When I was a baby, I trusted my mother, and look at the pain she gave me. I'm too afraid to trust somebody in the presence. The wall like that. But the woman said, no, I won't abandon. I'll be here for you. I'll be around. I'm not going to leave you. I don't want to risk that kind of, I can't bring up that kind of pain. So he dumped her and went back to finding women who will dump him, because that's what he's familiar with, to protect the wall. But these walls prevent healing at the same time. Hurt people search the world for just the right relationship that will make everything all right forever. That will fill the empty hole, provide missing nurturing, and give them the life, love, and security which got derailed because of trauma. They become fixated on finding it, and so begin a lifelong search. But they search for the wrong thing, and they search in the wrong places. Yeah, so the guy who runs to the slot machine, he's looking for the wrong thing. It's wrong to think that the machine is the mother's milk in the past. You're not supposed to look for that. It's the wrong thing to look for. The thing to look for is understanding, so you can forgive and mourn and grieve. So that's a defense against grieving. When you repeat it, that's a defense against grieving. That's what, you're looking for the wrong thing. You're avoiding the wrong thing. And you're going to the wrong place as well. The answer is not in the slot machine, or the casino place, whatever, right? But being tempted to do this, or doing it, is meant to get you to realize, what am I repeating here? I'm seem to doing the same thing over and over again. Am I supposed to make wink, hunch? Is there like a... Is my unconscious trying to say something to me? Hey, unconscious, why don't you just say directly to me what I'm supposed to know? Unconscious says, sorry, I don't have words here. You as a baby didn't speak yet. We didn't have words here. We remember it. I can only communicate by getting you to behave it. I'm the puppet master to get you like a puppet to do the thing. That's my way to communicate to you. Oh, I see. So you're getting me to replay symbolically what happened in the past so I can know what happened in the past. That's right. Okay, next one here, transference love. Okay, so again, transference love. So the baby lays down the wiring with the mother, but everything's frozen, right? Now in the present, if somebody has the same psychology like your mother, it's going to trigger up the wiring with the mother. Now embedded in the wiring with the mother, which we forgot, embedded within it, was a blissful oneness. So you're going to feel up now that blissful oneness. So now you're feeling all excited. You're all thunder, lightning, so frightening. All that knock on wood song. It's spellbound, trance, wow. You're the one. You know, look. So you're feeling the blissfulness that you felt with the mother in the uterus or shortly afterwards. Usually it's in the uterus time. So somebody in the present has the same psychology, same wiring like your mother's wiring. That triggers the wiring you laid down with your mother. So you think that person in the present with that wiring is your unconscious, your mother, like, so it flares it up, like you think you're back there. Oh, there, oh wow. Oh, like, oh my goodness. Oh, then you transfer that mother in the past to the person in the present. Yeah, because one person says, well, the person in the present is like an emotional reincarnation of the mother in the past. So you transfer the mother in the past to the person in the present. Oh, you're the one. You don't even know them. Don't even barely know them. It can happen in a few seconds. Then you're going to be disappointed. the way you were disappointed, to know that you were disappointed. So we repeat it, okay, to remember. So when you're disappointed by the person in the present, that's for you to know you were disappointed by the mother. That's why you chose that person, to know the story, to get the story. Narrative medicine. You repeat to remember. So you found somebody to recreate so you can remember what happened in the past. So the anger you feel to the person in the present, oh, you're a fluschwig, or you're a liar, you're a deceiver, you're so cruel, or, oh, you're so mean, you're cold like that, you're a deceiver, you're cheating me, how can you be so cruel? Like, okay, hold the phone here. Okay. You brought up those unconscious feelings now to know that that's really how you felt with the mother. So take it to the source like that. That person in the present is a little benign, like a little disappointing, but they didn't cause that kind of pain like that. So your trauma, yesterday's quote, you transfer your trauma mind to the present and all blurred up like that. You don't know what's real and what's the past. You gotta parse out what's present, what's the past. But strong emotions are for the past, usually. Oh, there's that song again. Yeah, this song keeps reminding me of that Wade on the Water song, right? Wade on the Water. Honey on the Rocks, all right. Oh, look, he just said the word sin in there. Oh, there it is again, my God. No baby's a sinner. Stop this nonsense. No baby's born sick. Oh my God. Okay, so that word sin means you're guilty of something. Why is the baby guilty of something? Why would a baby think he's in, well, if he's in pain, he thinks he did something wrong. He's being punished. If he's being punished, he did something wrong. The baby concludes that the mother rejects him, he's being punished. That means he did something wrong. The baby's just trying to understand the situation here, so he makes it up that he's guilty. But when someone else tells you, oh, you're a sinner like that, well, the person saying that is trying to say they feel guilty because they couldn't save their mother. They feel pain because the mother rejected them. That's code like that. It's projected to know within, as above, so below, inside out. Okay, transference stuff, the person in the present, when they disappoint you, to replay how you were disappointed, you're a fluschwiga, you say, heartbreaker. Oh, the mother broke your heart. You replay the heartbreaking experience to know that your heart was already broken in the past, but you don't remember it, so we repeat it to remember. Transference stuff is a sort of remembering, reacquainting myself with experiences, matching those stored in my memory bank, long forgotten, imprinted onto my brain in childhood. I was unconsciously looking to replace the love and comfort I had experienced as a small child and lost. To repair a painful past, to have security and family in my life again. Once we could clear out the unresolved pain from yesterday, the old baggage and transference reactions, we could react to each other in the present. This made conflicts immeasurably easier to solve because hurt feelings were just hurt feelings about what happened today and not weighed down by decades of repressed pain from the past that had been triggered by a present-day circumstance. So the present triggers the past. You see, so now you think you're in the past. And all those immense pain with the mother, that's pretty intense like that. So you're treating the part in the present. You want the part in the present to heal that pain in the past. It's too much of a demand, no one can do it. Victims of trauma assess each situation as if a threat or danger. Victims of trauma, developmental trauma, attachment trauma, relational trauma, interpersonal trauma, betrayal trauma, mother figure. Assess each situation as if it were some kind of danger, like in the past. And the intensity that these trauma survivors carry within themselves distorts their reactions to normal circumstances, inhibiting their ability to have normal relationships. They see danger where it doesn't exist, offense where none was intended. They attach themselves anxiously to people, driving them away because of their neediness. They tend to overreact, shut down, or withdraw, freeze, flight, or fight. The stress response. So we're the baby chooses, generally, Karen Horney's take is the baby's gonna choose one of those stress responses. Okay, the fight or the freeze. So in relationships, they tend to shut down. Okay, that's the freeze. No, that's the freeze, yeah. That's the space out one, shut down. Withdraw, that's the escape. And overreact, that's the fight one. So the prototype is we play it again and again like that. When divorce, for example, when divorce is not openly mourned, the grief goes underground. Where does it go? The answer to this is staring us right in the face, though it is often missed and mislabeled. For example, the pain of the divorce gets played out in the crowded court system, custody battles that turn children into unsuspecting carriers of family grief by children acting out, being a delinquent, drops in performances at school. It carries over into subsequent, often premature, relationships that become burdened with unresolved pain from previous relationships, or emotional eating to numb the emotional pain. So when there's a loss, how do you, there are many ways to keep you unaware of the pain. Okay, the emotional food stuff, the cigarettes are tranquilizers to numb the pain, manic behavior destructive. Oh, I just noticed, somebody's dog on the other side there. Okay, so when we don't mourn our losses, the pain goes underground. Where does that pain go? So all the things you're seeing out there, that's the pain of not mourning the loss. So why is it so hard to mourn a loss? Because the structure, the psychic structure, the memory template needed to mourn the loss is what's called I'm okay, you're okay, i.e. differentiation, where the child originally was loved enough by the mother to feel safe enough to differentiate from her, have a self-identity. With the self-identity, you have sadness at the console. If there's no self-identity and you're fused in the tar pit of a negative symbiosis where you even become the mother, how do you admit a loss if you have no identity, if you are the mother? That's a huge point. The only way to admit a loss is understanding. So you can try to understand the parents. That helps you to understand yourself. As you're understanding yourself, simultaneously, sadness appears. Sadness is Robert Bly, sadness is like grieving is the pathway to getting back your identity, getting back your feelings, getting back your embodiment. Sadness is all about the getting back. That's the importance of Inside Out, the message of Inside Out 1, the importance of sadness. Because he saw in the first film, the character said, Mr. Sadness, do me a favor, here's a little circle, you stand in the circle and just stay there, okay? And you push their toe in the circle and stay in the circle. Okay. In the second film, Inside Out 2, Sadness is at the console, hooray, Sadness is in the house. Kind of. So a huge difference like that, huge difference, that point right there. Scientists tell us today that our emotional bodies are just as physical as our corporal bodies, only harder to see and measure. There's a mysterious leap between mind and body, emotional body. Healing is biologically driven. We clean and suture the wound. That part we can do, but we cannot re-knit our flesh. Only nature can. Only nature can do that. So it is with the emotional wounds. Wounds to the heart need to be cleaned in order to naturally heal. A wound to the psycho-spiritual body can be just as crippling to a person as a wound to the physical body. Okay, so Capex's version of this is, or the psychosomatic theory about this is, the baby's crying to the mother, screaming to the mother, "Mother, you didn't meet my needs. I'm scared here, I'm crying, I'm in pain, I'm enraged like this. Mother, come on, change your ways." Mother gaslights the baby. Then what? What does the baby do with those feelings? It's got to go somewhere, turns inward. Down goes to an organ. At some point, you're going to get a psychosomatic symptom. Capex says psychosomatic symptoms are just the continuation of that crying and screaming to the mother originally. But this time, it's kind of concealed, but the pain reveals it. Originally, it was relational and functional, because between the baby and the mother, and you can see it like that. Now, when it goes inwardly, okay, you don't really see it, so it's kind of revealed, but the pain of the symptom reveals it. So psychosomatic symptoms reveal and conceal that pain with the mother. Sarno says back hypertension and back pain is that rage you had at the mother as a baby. It went to the musculature, now you got body armor like this. His theory. John E. Sarno. Mysterious sleep between mind and body. The body remembers. The body keeps the score. Every body tells a story. So when you grieve, of course, when you get back to your beingness, things sort itself out and the symptoms go away. I'll go back to the psychodrama. Okay, if we are interviewed in the role of a parent and answer questions as them, we can come to understand their limitations, their sense of unresolved issues. So to have empathy for your parents in the healing journey, why don't you just play them? Just pretend to be one of your parents. Ask your buddy to play you and ask you questions. And you talk to your friend playing the role of you, and you play the role of one of the parents. As you're doing it, you observe it, and now you know what's going on with your parents like that. And if you want, you can flip it. All right, friend, enough of this. You play the parent. I'm going to play myself now. You can flip it, and you can flip it around like that. And you're going to have a third person maybe offering some ideas or something. Or you can then have someone else play both, you and the parent, and you observe meta like third, and you can see the whole thing like that. So this is the psychodrama stuff, right? So you ask two of your friends, all right, you play me, you play the parent, give him a little coaching, a little basics like that. All right, go play it out, and you observe it, and you can coach. All right, no, enough, I'm going to play it now. I'll play me. All right, okay, now you play the parent, I'll play me. Okay, no, you play me and you two both, you play the two, and I'll observe. Then you can step into one, flip it, step into the other, flip it. The other two can flip it, So this is psychodrama. It's meant to bring up and to see and to understand. Because if you're saying, funny thing she said was, if you're playing the role of a parent and you're saying all that stuff and you have a little empathy like that, and you receive that, The dialogue will improve somehow. The dialogue will improve. Yeah, I'm sort of saying, I haven't finished it yet. I just started. Okay, lastly, clients who succeeded in therapy. Okay, they're able to look. They're able to, quote unquote, look in the mirror. Man in the mirror, Michael Jackson. If you want to heal the people, start with the man in the mirror. Heal the world, heal the people, heal the people. You want to heal the people. I.e. heal the world, heal the people. We'll start with the man in the mirror. Start with the person you see in the mirror. Look in the mirror. What do you see in the mirror? Start with that person. Start with that person. So you're able to look at your own, you're able to self-reflect. Look at, in the mirror, that person. What do they think, feel, say? What are they doing? Notice this. Have some distance like that. Feel it and observe it so that you can see yourself realistically. Put words to it, articulate it somehow. Separate the past from the present, which allows you to live in the present without sabotaging the present with unresolved, unfinished business from the past. Healing is a series of quiet awakenings born of the willingness to struggle to have a true and honest encounter with yourself. That's called self-activation. So Masterson's line is, self-activation leads to abandonment, depression, which leads to I can see a guy smoking across the street there. So Janov says, when the guy reaches for the cigarette, does he know that he's in pain, that he wasn't comforted? He didn't get mother's comfort. Something triggered it, and he got pain. And the pain, he wanted to tranquilize it. Janov calls cigarettes tranquilizers. I just saw a guy smoke across the street there. Same with the cookies. When the person's opening up the cupboard to get some biscotti, does the person know that they were not comforted by the mother? And that's why they're reaching for the cookies. So first, defense before content. So first you notice the defense. You're reaching for the cookies because you weren't comforted. It's better that way than, or it's considered more helpful that way than the other way. Oh, I wasn't comforted, and that's why I'm reaching for the cookies. No, I'm reaching for the cookies because I wasn't comforted. Then it gives you a little pause like that. That's Roger Gould's theory from his book called Shrink Yourself. Analyze this. Oh, there's that reggae song. Yeah, they got one reggae song on this thing here. Once again, go to Radio Agogo, the most recent episode. So that'd be like August 11th or 12th or something, 2024. The reggae show. It was a very good one. I liked most of the songs in there, pretty good. And I talked about he found a reggae cover of Ann Peoples' song called I Can't Stand the Rain. This reggae singer from Jamaica, Hortense Ellis, she does a very good cover. I normally can't stand that song, but now I can stand it. Now I can stand I Can't Stand the Rain. Let's stop. Healing is a series of quiet awakenings. Yeah. So each time you pull up the ramp here, the Rapunzel, each time you pull up the Rapunzel, that's like a bit of your soul kind of thing, and you get it back. It's a quiet process, bit by bit, little ahas, aha, little ahas, little quiet awakenings, bit by bit. Some people get a huge awakening. Usually it's like little awakenings, bit by bit. Now the guava juice, it's gone. I can't get it, I can't find it. What a pity, eh? Yeah. That was a great drink. For a short time, I found fresh pressed guava juice, like the really good one, and now it's totally gone. Now you can buy some watered down thing or something. Okay, so your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to read these 9 quotes and just pick one. Pick the most touching one, the most interesting one, and just do something with it. Send it to yourself. You know, you can buy those blank notebooks, right? Handwrite it down. I think that's a good one. Just handwrite it down. Just slowly handwrite it down. Neatly, calligraphy maybe, I don't know. Just mindfully handwrite it down. Slowly copy it. So then now you're active, now you're thinking about the quote. As you're writing it down, helps you to pause and slowly think about, oh, just one a day. That's Rob Bly's advice. It's a slow, quiet awakening. You don't push it, don't rush it. It's a prompt to make you aware. Then that might trigger up a dream. That's the idea. So if you get an insight in a day, that means you're building a basket. So at night when you sleep, feelings can come up. See, dreaming is like trying to help you to feel what you couldn't have felt. Make you aware of what you couldn't know. That's materials trying to come up to you like that. So you communicate to yourself that you're willing to accept your feelings when you create a nest first. So each quote is like a little nest kind of thing. So that's the hope. One out of ten, we'll offer that. So let's see, for myself here, let's see. So pick one. So for me today, let's see. Yeah, looking for the wrong thing in the wrong place, okay. The walls one, okay. The divorce one, yeah, okay. So it's displaced. We're acting out the pain. Is okay. Okay, the famous pattern, you move towards people, away from people, or against people. So Karen Horney's version of this is, when there's trauma, we tend to pathologically move towards people. Hang on. Oh, sorry. No, this is the stress response. Sorry. Okay, so against people, that's the fight one. Away from people, that's the freeze one. And it's disassociation, the deer one. Like the body's there. When you see the deer on the highway, his body's there, right? He's, right? Yeah, that's quite an image. So the deer, the headlights, right? So the deer is in the middle of the road and the headlights are there. He's not moving. His body's frozen there. But his mind is spaced out, but the body's stuck there. That's quite a thing, right? It's called disassociation. So he's like, he's immobilized. He doesn't know what to do. He can't fear, he can't fight. So his mind flights. So these are kids who are daydreaming all the time in school, can't concentrate. Maybe they had school shock. Yeah, we have one quote about that, the school shock. There was so much shouting going on in the home and all this. When he went to the school, he was easily overwhelmed by what's going on at the school. So the pain of the home life and all the going-ons and the angry teacher, whatever, and naughty kids nearby, whatever. He spaced out and was daydreaming, and that's called school shock. So the teacher's always got a learning disability. No, he doesn't have a learning disability. Nonsense. He doesn't have enough safety at home to feel grounded in the school like that, so he can concentrate in school. He's already stressed out at home, and now he's doubly stressed out by the dysfunctional narcissistic teachers who shout at the kids or whatever. So he's spacing out like that. That's one theory, the jargon called school shock. I don't hear anybody use that phrase, so it's not a perfect phrase, but a variation of the shutdown one, the deer in the headlights one. Deer in the headlights, oh, Jesus. The body-mind one, okay, that's fair enough. Okay, the metaphor that we want to, just like physically, you want to clean the wound and nature does the rest. The same thing with the emotions, okay. This one here, yeah, about the psychodrama. Yeah, you play your parents.
So just try it with your friend. Hey, I want to do role play with you. I want you to, fairly well. I want you to play me, imitate me. You know, I want to play the parent. I want to interact. I want you to interact with me playing my parent. I want to see what I say. I want to see what comes up when I play the role of my parent. I want to see what it's like. I want to just bring it up like that. And I want to see you playing me. So you do that. Okay, let's switch, flip. I'll be me, you be the parent. And flip, flip again. And sometimes you can bring in a third to play what you were playing, and you can observe the distance, you can observe the two like that. Yeah. She calls that a Greek drama. like a Greek drama in ancient times. My favorite's the second one, yeah, number two here. This one here about the grief, all right. Yeah, I think this is a good one here, number two here. Number one is good as well, but number two is, I think, quite good. Okay, yeah, in number one, this one here, you want to separate the past from the present, which allows you to live in the present without sabotaging the present with your old, unresolved, unfinished business from the past. That's what we're trying to do. That, in a nutshell, is what we need to do. Separate the present from the past, rather than seeing the past, reading the past from the painful lens of yesterday, filled with unresolved, unfinished business from the past. Okay, clients seem to need to go through a process of active grieving of early childhood losses in order to be able to move into adult roles. If they don't go through this, if they remain locked in the pain associated with early loss, they unconsciously have such a strong yearning for the original lost object, Janoff calls it symbolic acting out, that they spend much of their time hoping, wishing, and trying to make their present out-of-day relationships into that. So that's called projective identification, controlling people, twisting people. I love you, you're perfect, now change please, be the good mother. Don't be a better version of my mother. Be the good mother so you're trying to create, you're trying to like wrench the present to a better version of the past. But the present isn't the past, it doesn't make sense. So we move through cycles of hope, disappointment. Access to adulthood is blocked because we're stuck in the unfinished business associated when we were a child. These are wounds that can go unattended in our need to get on with life. Now here's the thing, insult to injury. We seem to see feelings of grief as some kind of weakness. In fact, grieving requires a strong ego and builds a strong ego because it asks you to stand beside yourself, beside your pain, while you're allowing yourself to have it, like a double ego there. You're experiencing it and you're aware that you're experiencing it. So you're holding it, that's the containing one, you're containing it. Okay, it asks us to be strong and compassionate and wise enough to hold on, to hold our own woundedness in our hearts, self-compassion. That's you when you were wounded. Can you be a good parent to yourself without abandoning yourself? There's nothing weak about that. There's nothing weak about that. There's nothing weak about self-compassion. Quite the opposite. So we got a lasso of truth. Okay, that's 71. Yeah, 2071. Okay, next time we'll do 7. So we'll do two more sort of like this. Okay, if you like today's quotes, we got two more coming up. And maybe even another one after that. Oh, this is a very rare tree. Usually there's like a cackling, desperate housewives, women's club coming here. Usually when I come here, there's a group of housewives, and they really get going, like they're cackling all afternoon long. I call call him the desperate husband. Because the husband's at work and the kids are at school. Okay, I won't do a preview of tomorrow's one. But these are tomorrow's ones. Yeah, the first one here. When people with unresolved grief and pain from the past enter into intimate adult relationships, they bring their pain with them. In a split second, the past and present become an indistinguishable mud of emotion, muddle. Soon, the full force of the old pain gets acted out in the present, projected onto the screen of the relationship, not the one that caused it, but the one that triggered it. Look at that, eh? So the person in the present just triggers the past, and all the pain of the past, you assign it to the triggering person, someone who just happens to resemble your mother, and you, all that pain with the mother, you transfer to the person in the present. That person in the present isn't your mother in the past, but that's the power of the unconscious. You got so much pain in the past, the present is still the past. That mother's your mother in the past. That person in the present is your mother in the past emotionally. Even though materially you recognize the person's not your mother, but you're acting like that person's your mother, and you fully believe it, and you're fully adamant about it, and you're fully determined, because that's your loyalty, that's your attachment, that's a symptom of trauma, that we don't distinguish the present and the past. That brainstem doesn't know time. How are we doing here? Today's a short video. Yeah, today's a shorter video. That's okay. We can make it a shorter video today. That's okay. Yeah, why don't we do that instead of my dragging it out? Depends on my mood. If I'm energized more, I can. Or I just take a break and see how we go. We still got time, hey? We still got some. This is rare. I'm usually rushing because of the light. What is it? 4 o'clock, yeah. I got two. Theoretically, if I took a break, we can go on for 2 more hours, right? What do you think? Just wrap it up or keep going? Actually, we could go on this. I've never done that. We could go on the Sky Train. I want to buy some little groceries, maybe. You want to see that? That I can talk on the way. Privacy. I try not to get people in the camera. That's part of it too. Okay, let's just go to the balcony and wrap it up there. Yeah. Showing up here. Oh, there's a broom salesman. We can get that in. Yeah. Okay. Let's see. He's on a like a tricycle kind of thing. Can we get him in? You can buy mops and brooms and sweepers. Chimney sweeping, yeah. That the first term, he's selling little sweepers, right? The first term associated with psychoanalysis was by the first client, psychoanalysis's first client, Bertha, a woman named Bertha Bethelheim, they say, Anna, nicknamed Anna O. She called free association chimney sweeping. Chimney sweeping is cleaning out kind of thing. Purification, chimney sweep, bit by bit. And then Freud said, let's call it the talking cure instead. Chimney sweeping. A talking cure. A variation of verbal medicine, verbal therapy. How are we doing? Oh, it's too... The lighting's not too good here. Where can I get good lighting? Oh, is there no... Can't get... This is just a tiny little balcony. It's just basically this. Those three little smoker spots. That's... Really? Can't get... It's too bright here. I just see like a kind of a glare. I can't really see much. Okay, let's close it up here anyway. So. Any final thoughts here? Somebody said that if you have fun, if you feel pleasure mocking psychoanalysis, mocking people's efforts to heal, then you're a shattered Freudian. The normal state of affairs is Freudian, Freuder. The normal thing is Freudian, Freuder. Pleasure at other people's happiness. So Schadenfreude is code that the mother got some benefit when she hurt the child. She got some benefit. She got some pain relief. She got some comfort somehow. So the baby identifies with the aggressor. So when they shame others, see others in pain, that's them in pain. But they're the mother who gave them pain. They become the mother. So in the replay, they find proxies to play them and mock them. And they laugh at that, because they feel safe, and tension is released because you got back your mother. You feel safe with your mother because you are the mother, so you replayed it. And since you're the mother, you feel one with the mother, you feel safe. You're not the victim anymore. The proxy is playing the role of you as a victim. You are the victim, but you don't know it. You play the mother. So when you act like the mother, you feel safer. So when you shame yourself, getting the proxy to play you, that's called Schadenfreude, the pleasure of other people's, your own pain, because the mother got pleasure at the baby's pain. Oh, cunning tale. So the normal state of affairs is Freudenfreude. Freudenfreude. Maybe one day that'll be the word of the year. Freudenfreude. So Bert, he was joking. Mr. Freud wasn't a very cheerful guy, they said, because he didn't have the E. Freud is joy. His name is only Freud. If he had the E, he'd be happier, but we joked. Freud and Freud. Gee. It's still so... Oh, how about here? Is that a little better like that? Yeah, okay. I see it myself. Look at this. Wrap it up here. Any final thoughts here? Your mission, you have your mission, okay, to read the 9 quotes and pick one. Another mission, should you choose to accept it, is to see if you can find the comic psychoanalysis, the comic strip, 1955 comic strip called Psychoanalysis. Every 3 months, they put out one issue. It ran for a year, so 4 issues. The complete run of the thing was reissued 4 years ago, February 2000. It got reissued both in hardback and in digital format, Dark Horse Publishing. The complete run offers 12 therapy sessions put into comic book format. So it's clear, it's fun, well, very well written. It's the best, still in my humble opinion, the best introduction. If you want to get a quick
feel for what this is about. I think that comic's pretty good. It teaches family systems theory, the scapegoating, the triangling thing. It talks about the Don Juan syndrome, okay, the Playboy one, the womanizer one, separation anxieties in there. Projecting your inner, like if the mother hates the baby, that's called the inner critic. That voice you project onto everybody, you think everybody's criticizing you. So Ellen was always shy like that, thinking everybody's criticizing her. And because she would withdraw and climb up, self-fulfilling prophecy, everyone did reject her. Everyone's called her such a snob like that, because she was projecting the inner critic voice, okay, onto everybody. You see, so that issue of projecting the inner critic. A little bit about dream interpretation. I mentioned already in the that so Pete Docter announced he's going to do a TV show called Dream Productions. So we got one quick clue of maybe what's to come. In the original Inside Out film, there was a scene where Riley's teeth were falling out. Okay. So in the under stress we regress. So she had a lot of pain around the losses. She had a lot of losses, a lot of pain. So if you can't face the pain of the loss, you go back to the time of the uterus. Okay. So when she's in a pathological nostalgia going back to the uterus in the dream, there's no teeth. The baby doesn't have teeth there. So as she's going back in the dreaming, the teeth fall out. See, that's the regression of going back to the time when the baby doesn't have teeth. That's the regression like that. So a pathological nostalgia. Okay, so you're looking for some safe feelings to deal with the pain of the present. So you regress like that. So maybe that's the kind of thing we might be getting. I'm not sure. How about this way? Jesus, it's pretty kind of dark all around here. How about that? Any final thoughts here? The comic, so again, your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to read that comic, find that comic. I doubt if you'll find the original print. So back in 55, it was only 10 cents for one issue, right? I think if you can find it, it's like $1,000 now. But if you can even find it, don't bother. The reprint is okay, the hardback reissue is good enough. It's clear enough. It's colorful and it's very vibrant like that. It does its job. It's good. So get the hardback if you can get it. It's still around, secondhand copy of it. Or get the digital version of it on your iPhone. That's the best introduction to psychoanalysis. I mentioned the Janoff quotes. Another mission, should you choose to accept it at some point, is to go to the Janoff material, 2745-70. Is that right? Yeah. And then the abreaction, the release, the avalanche scene, 71 to 73, very important point there about this abreaction. There's the normal one and there's the sham one, the fake one, the blowing off steam one, like what actors do, pretending to be someone who has feelings. And by that, you think you have those feelings yourself? No, that's sham stuff. That's what actors do. They pretend to have feelings. That's not a genuine abreaction. So there's a difference between what the actors do and what a genuine, and how a person genuinely feels something, linking to their memory and feeling what you couldn't have felt, knowing what you couldn't have known. That's the release, the abreaction. So 71 to 73, we got three videos. All of the quotes for those videos are just specifically on that one term. And it took me, 9 hours or something to sort through the difference between healthy abreaction, genuine abreaction, and the sham stuff. Janoff's way of doing it is to call the genuine stuff primal healing. And the sham one, he calls it abreaction.
because the English translation make associates ab as negative. Negative reaction, ab reaction. No, in German, ab reaction means it's a positive feeling. It's the delayed release and onset of your feeling. That's a healing thing, ab reaction. He means it like that. So in German, the ab is a positive. But when the translators kept the ab, it confuses people, because in English, the prefix ab is like abnormal, like no, like not good, right? So that's why we don't have Freud quotes due to the disturbed translation. Like, let's say in German, Freud said something, it took him 10 words to say. The English translator guy took 35 words to say and just twisted around, double think. So we don't really do that. Only when a German person translates it, that all included. If Bergler or Karen Horney or Helmut Kaiser or any of our German authors here, that's different. That's a different story. The exception is Laponche and Pontalis. These are French guys, but they know English and German. So they have a dictionary called The Language of Psychoanalysis, 1969. Very good book. I've already plucked out the best definitions of those terms in our collection. Henry Hart is also a bit of an exception. I don't know about the... I got a hunch he does know German, that's why I included just a couple like that. The other exception is since Masterson says the essay is okay, memory, repeating, and working through, we have one quote from that essay. So, luckily, thousands of people have waded through the perverted translations and saved some of the good parts, and then thankfully for that. So that's what a relief. Jeez, we've got a little gratitude for all that labor. It might be easier to learn German first and just read it in German first and understand Freud's metaphors or jokes or little plays or whatever he was doing, little metaphors or something. Plus, he's early on doing it. He's exploring it and updating. And a lot of it was metaphor. But the translator said, let's confuse people, make people think it's real. No, it was a metaphor. No, it's real. See, but that's why we don't have Jung. Same thing with Jung. Lacan, same thing with Lacan. All this convoluted, made-up jargon. It's just red herrings. It's vague. It's confusing. It's doublethink. It's part of the disinformation. It's to be a red herring to distract people. Oh, it's the electric rabbit, yesterday's line. Sobonfu, an indigenous woman from Africa, Ghana or something like that. Oh, correction. Yesterday I made a mistake. I got Mali and Malawi mixed up. Sorry about that. So correction there. Mali is that country has two syllables, Mali, two syllables. Malawi has three syllables, Malawi, yeah, has three syllables. So Malawi is sort of in the east, southeast of Africa, and Mali is sort of more like in the northwest, kind of like on the opposite ends kind of thing. I got a little mix up there. Oh yeah, so this indigenous speaker, you can see the clip on YouTube. She said that somebody took her, so she's from a village in Africa and all this. They took her to a village. She saw some racehorses, greyhounds or whatever. And she said, that's very strange. All these dogs chasing a metallic machine rabbit, right? They're chasing the rabbit. And some prankster in the audience threw a real rabbit in the field, and all the dogs diverted to the real rabbit, everybody's complaining, boo, who's doing this and all this. And she said, oh, that's it. That's it. That's the image. That's a good metaphor. We're chasing this fake thing. We're missing the real thing. Look at those dogs. They're looking for the real thing. So that's the embodiment. Yesterday with Robert Bly, go to yesterday's video about the Robert Bly poem about, he said, he's surprised when people talk about fish being thirsty, fish in the ocean being thirsty. That one there. Not a bad one. Yeah, okay. Oh, somebody coming out? What's this? No? Oh, no, okay, okay. I thought someone was trying to come in here or something. Any final thoughts here? That gives me an idea. Maybe I could bring a chair out here. I could sit out here and do it, right? So we mentioned Masterson's book, The Search for the Real Self. There's also Karen Horney's book called Our Inner Conflicts. That's a good one. So, yeah, today's phrase, gentle awakening. These are just gentle awakenings. Gentle, what did you call it? Gentle awakenings? Quiet awakenings. Oh, yeah, quiet awakenings. So you observe your behavior pattern. Where'd you learn it? You're interacting in the present, trying to see the present as a new replay of the past, trying to undo the past, change the past, get the love that's in the past. And that's the power of the unconscious. Yeah, one of Bergler's comparisons around the difference between the power of the conscious and the power of the unconscious. Well, one little example he had was imagine a bunch of luxurious tall skyscrapers, like luxury hotels and things and all that. And the owner, and you don't know who the owner is, he's invisible, maybe he's on a yacht somewhere in the Virgin Islands or something. But the point is, the owner of the buildings is invisible. Now look at the doorman. He's visible. You see him. You see the doorman, but you don't see the owner. Now the doorman might be braggadocio and all that, but truly, who has more power? The invisible owner of the complex or the doorman who thinks he's a big shot? That's kind of like us with our conscious and our unconscious. Inside Out is playing as I speak. The theaters are having, every theater has it. Yeah, once again, 2840 for a discussion on Inside Out 2. So when Pete Docter puts out his Dream Productions TV show, keep in mind timelessness. Keep in mind that something can represent something else. Keep in mind that it might be like a homeostasis thing where you wanna have this unconscious wish fulfillment. So you wanna fulfill your wishes, but you couldn't do it during the day. So you dream at night and you do it at night. So you get your homeostasis kind of thing. But it tells you your status of your inner structure, what you're replaying, like what it is. So it's based on your structure. If your structure is in the narcissistic area, you know, it might be a regression to feel important again. hope to get love. So you had maybe a romantic dream or something, or potential, and it got it, and you woke up. Yeah. So if you won't email, I'll find somebody who will, right? So maybe that guy would have a dream where he's dreaming, and a girl's nice to him. He wakes up. He freaked out. Like, so here he is having a dream like that. Maybe next time he has a dream, and then the woman left him. Oh, he felt okay. The woman left him, he felt okay. Then he had a dream where a woman did leave him. Oh, he woke up. So the strong emotions that you're having a hard time accept, because you can't hold it anymore, you're going to wake up, you know, so that kind of thing. So that moment of when you're waking up and you might be panting and all this, that's a clue to the feeling you're having a hard time accepting. And feelings are linked to needs. F and N, feelings and needs. So always keep in mind F and N. If there's a feeling, it's in relation to whether a need, an underlying need, got met or unmet. If the needs are met, the feelings are pleasant. If the needs are unmet, those pleasant feelings zoop away, like joy and sadness popping away. Not popping away, like going, but flying away. And then you go back to the survival brain of the anger. Okay? So Mr. Rosenberg's famous mantra is, anger is an expression of unmet needs. You can see him on YouTube there, NBC, the Mr. NBC guy. Anger is an expression of unmet needs. Because if the needs were met, the feelings of joy would be there. So joy wasn't there, then you go back to the survival brain. Okay, because when the baby's needs don't get met, he thinks he's a goner. So that's why he's angry, he's scared. He's angry. Because he thinks he's scared and he's angry. Fear, anger, it's kind of linked like that. The fear quickly turns over to anger easily. So the fear and anger are kind of blurred. So of course, when there's anger, there's a deep underlying fear. And the fear means the person couldn't escape to feel safe. So then it clicks over to anger kind of thing. I'm in a nice part of town. These are expensive buildings. It'd be very pricey to live in this area. It's close to the SkyTrain kind of thing. And this is sort of like a uptown kind of thing, a little bit uptown. This is not the most busiest part of the city. It's a busy area, but it's not as busy as the main area. I couldn't do this in the busiest of the busiest areas. This area is like partially residential, partially tourist commercial kind of thing. I only recently discovered this little spot here. I've only been here a half a dozen times. Oh, I'm relieved. Yeah, the women's club didn't come today. That's a relief. These cackling women here. It would be interesting to have it translate. I wouldn't mind like hearing so we can how externalized are they? Is it all externalized? Like, is the woman's cackling, is it all about shaming them guys, blaming the guys, how foolish the guys are? Oh yeah, you know what my husband did? Ha ha. Oh yeah, you know how dumb my husband is? Ha ha. Maybe they're doing that kind of stuff. I don't know. Or do they discuss between themselves? Do they make eye statements between themselves? Do they say, a friend, you know, you said you'd call at 5, and when you didn't, I was triggered with the past, and I would bring that to you. I felt a little hurt by that. Now that's just a trigger, but I want to share the past that's coming up. So I'm not going to blame you because you're the trigger. That's a benign thing. But since you're my friend, I need a chance to talk about the past. The friend might say, I have a confession. I was passive aggressive. I made you wait because I was angry at you. I expressed it by being passive aggressive. So I expressed it passively, quietly by making you wait. And that's why you do it. Okay. So they make a nice statement. Yeah, because because you did something that made me angry. Oh, I see. Could you make it? Yeah, so 2 weeks ago, so you go back and forth making I statements. So that's between them, processing, working through, suffering through, and you feel better, obviously, when you do that kind of thing. And it builds trust because people are putting words to their feelings. When this happened, I felt that. So for more information on the I statements, how to make an I statement, 2360 is not a bad one. So your mission, another mission. Yesterday I was very light on the mission, so I'm a little heavy today. 2360, look up 2360, Susan Campbell's version on how to make an I statement. She calls it the unilateral repair statement. It's pretty good. It comes from her self-help book entitled From Triggered to Tranquility. And yesterday's quote is, yesterday's a good one. When you identify that you're transferring the past to the present, all this emotions in the present, then when you do that, the air of the emotions, the balloon pops down, and there's an arrow that takes you, and the flag is in the past telling you the unfinished business. So that help, that imagery helps you to know what's past is past, what's present is the present, to differentiate. So you the balloon, the air of the present, okay, that goes away, but the broken balloon flops back to the past. The balloon turns into a stake. There it is. There's the unfinished business of the past. That's the best quote we have so far by Miss Dayton, that one about go to yesterday's one about transference, the second half of the batch of quotes. The first half were the propaganda quotes. The second half was that one by Miss Dayton. Excellent quote. Really good quote on transference. A major topic. We'll continue to add more quotes on transference. We need that lasso of truth. These quotes are building this lasso of truth to help us get the truth will upset you free. So why not play yesterday's song again? It's Hortense Ellis's cover of Ann Peoples' song called I Can't Stand the Rain. Now I can't stand the original of that, although I like Ann Peoples, but I like the Jamaican reggae cover of it. It's a fun one, yeah. Hortense, her first name, last name Ellis, a reggae singer from Jamaica. She makes the song kind of fun, yeah. We have one song by Ann Peoples on our soundtrack. A song of hers entitled, Fill This World With Love. Fill This World With Love. If you're looking for meaning, looking for something valuable, well, fill this world with understanding. The quest for healing, the quest for understanding. Fill this world with love. I notice a lot of gospel kind of groups sing that song. There's two versions of it. 76, I think, and another one. One version is a little bit, I prefer one of the versions. That reminds me of Pharaoh. Pharaoh, we have a couple of songs by the folk singer Pharaoh on there. One of them is funny. It's called Ain't Life a Brook. Ain't Life a Brook. That song title can be good for the humor topic. In the first part of a joke, you feel a little tense. Well, what's he gonna say here? Like, ain't life a... Uh-oh. It's a brook. Oh. Ups and weaves and detours and windings and ups and downs. It's a brook. Water flows. Journey. Brook. Ain't life a brook? Because you thought you were worried. There was suspense. Little tension. Unknown. Ain't life a... So then when you get the answer, the second half, brook, oh, you calm down. That's the humor pattern. The benign violation of your expectations. So the first part of the joke, benign tension, get the answer, you feel safe. When you feel safe, Before you felt tense, the release is laughter. So if it's benign, you laugh, right? Now this laughter is gonna correlate to your psychic structure. If the person operates from the paranoid schizoid mode of experiencing, okay, so it can be Schadenfreude, put down humor, or if the structure is the depressive position, it's more playful and helpful and all that. No one gets hurt kind of thing. Now that same mechanism is considered to be similar to grief. When you feel safe with a caring witness, the deeper feelings can be released. That's the abreaction, that's the grieving. So if it's mild tension, it's mild stuff, you might laugh. If it brings up the deeper stuff, you'll grieve and mourn. But in both cases, it's the safety that lifts it up, right? The safety. So therapy is sometimes the analogy of humor is therapy, because in therapy you feel safe with the caring witness. And because you feel safe with the caring witness, then you grieve and heal. Well, in a joke, you feel safe when you got the answer of the punchline or whatever. So I was just thinking that song title is like that. Ain't life a brook? Ain't life a brook? A brook. It's a helpful answer, right? It's a brook. Life is a brook. Ups and downs. We're all going to get disappointed. A little reality like that. Okay, let's wrap it up here. Can I get a... What's that? Or can I get a closing? Closing. I'm being a little silly here. Well, that's not bad, right? That's an intro, the reflection. That's an interesting close up here. Let's close it up here then. Okay, thanks very much. We'll see you in 72. No, what is it? I think it was 72, right? One or two. I'll see you, whatever it is, 71 or two. And today was 71, yeah. So I'll see you in 72, 20 and 72. I'll see you then, yeah. So for the love of narrative medicine, okay, close up with Katya Epstein's Katya, K-A-T as in Tom, J-A, her first name, Epstein with a B as in Bob, Eb. Okay, she sings our theme song. She does a German cover of the song Windmills of the Mind. It opens up with the bass tubas. Great song, wonderful song. I wish I could play it for you. My favorite English rendition is the one done by Barbara Lewis in English. So let's play the bass tubas, round, like a spiral. And I'll see you in the next video. For the love of narrative medicine.